Can I ask Assembly Broadcasting to keep all members in the spotlight for the next four items? Item one is apologies. Can I ask members if you're aware of any apologies? Nope, okay. Agenda item two then is chairperson's business. Can I refer members to correspondence from committee and member support team at page five regarding restrictions on attendance at committee meetings during the COVID-19 lockdown? Members, we agreed at last week's meeting to take today's business in a fully virtual meeting. I would seek your patience with any slight delays and ask for your full cooperation as always with regards to our agenda and our witnesses. Any questions about the fully virtual format? Everyone hearing and seeing okay so far? Yep, that's great. Okay, agenda item 2.2 is the Department of Education response on COVID-19 restrictions and the impact on youth organisations. Can I refer members to a response from the department on this at page 3 of table papers and ask members to note the response in relation to vaccination? Can I also seek the committee agreement to forward this response to the youth organisations that briefed us at our meeting of Wednesday, the 13th of January, seeking their reviews on the response? That agreed? Agreed? Thank you. Okay, agenda item 2.3 is our post-primary transfer. Can I refer members to a response from the department on post-primary transfer tests at page 9? Of table papers. The department has indicated that as the tests have been cancelled this year, that the concerns raised in this particular correspondence no longer arise. A committee content to note that response? Agreed? Yeah, happy to take any other comments in relation to post-primary transfer, but just seek an agreement on noting that response. Yeah, Robbie, go ahead. Go ahead, see if we can, you should be in the spotlight. Can you go ahead and speak and we'll see if we can hear you? No, no sound. Can I ask broadcasting to make sure that Robbie is audible? Okay, I'm happy to come back to you on that, Robbie, and see if we can get that sorted as well. Obviously the committee prioritised the foreseeable challenges with post-primary transfer since May last year. We wrote to all selected schools in May. We conducted our survey in the summer. We passed a motion in November, all calmly and clearly, without prejudice to anyone's positions in relation to academic selection, seeking schools and the minister's contingency plans in relation to post-primary transfer this year. Right up to this point when we have all been asking the minister to consider bringing forward a common contingency criteria. I don't know about other members, but I'm already receiving correspondence about extremely anxious and even stronger than that children in relation to some of the various criteria that is starting to be published. I know that isn't finalised until the 2nd of February, but I think there are significant concerns with regards to what that non-common criteria use is going to mean for children and young people across Northern Ireland. I understand we have invited the Education Minister to attend committee on this matter, and we haven't had a positive response to date. Any other members want to come in at that point? Robbie, you're definitely not on mute, by the way, yourself.
Yeah, I got it now.
Good man, go ahead.
It wouldn't unmute every second or two ago, so I won't press the button genuinely, Chair. So
here you
back on the other one, yes, happy enough with the response, except to say that, as I raised yesterday with the Minister in the Chamber, we have a cohort of P6s who will be perhaps looking to do the test or something similar in November 2021. It will be the new P7s. So whilst the response might be accurate for this cohort, a lack of planning and a failure to have contingencies and mitigations in place will not be acceptable. And I mean it will not be acceptable. I will go to town on this. I'm prepared to go to town on what's happening with the over 16,000 P7 pupils at the moment who are being let down, the single parent families who are being discriminated against. I can't overstate enough how much of a debacle that I consider this to be. So I can't say that their answer is wrong, but again, it's disappointing. What they could have at least alluded to is that lessons have and will be learned, and actually they have a team purposed to ensure that this is not repeated, Chair.
Yeah, I'm obviously endeavouring not to step beyond the realm of my chairpersonship here this morning into party positions, but I'm on the record as loudly and clearly saying that, in my opinion, the Education Minister has abdicated responsibility on the post-primary transfer of thousands of children across Northern Ireland.
Chair, yep. Chair, I need to say this. I think you're absolutely right, but in reality, can anybody hand on heart here say that they are content with how things are at the moment, regardless of what the position is? I doubt it very much, and that's what I said yesterday. I don't think there's any member of the Education Committee who, in good conscience, would have been happy with this outcome, regardless of ideology.
No, I absolutely agree. It's not acceptable, and we are seeing the consequence of a lack of contingency plan unfolding in these next few weeks. And people have made a fair point to me as well, Robbie, that the outcome of the applications to these wide and varied criteria will not now be known until June, it's my understanding. So that anxiety and that concern has lasted the primary 7 year for 10 and 11 year old children. And I know you're right, it's not acceptable on anyone's terms.
Yeah.
Anyway, Deputy Chair, Karen, go ahead there.
Yeah, can I just come in and follow up from Robbie? Obviously, you know, Robbie's outlined there in terms of people's position, and our position on academic selection is clear, but I do fully agree with all our members. It's not acceptable. And what we're seeing in relation to the criteria, the varied criteria, is very, very scary, and the hands-off approach from the Minister and his department is absolutely not acceptable. We've outlined to him the potential of a mess coming forward, as Robbie said, and yourself, not just for this cohort, but for the primary six in November, who's going into primary seven. And you know, we've also relayed in relation to the information we're getting of the increased numbers, potentially that will be more numbers unplaced in September. So it's not acceptable. We're raising all this in a timely manner, and the Minister needs to step in, and the department now, and put more support and provision in place. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Karen. Yeah, personally agree. Any other members wish to comment on that? As I said, we invited the Education Minister, we invited AQE and PPTC to attend the committee on this matter, and they did not receive a positive response. My understanding is we've also invited the Education Minister to attend the committee on February the 10th, as our session next week is scheduled to look at the Vulnerable Children Action Plan and meet with the Interim Mental Health Champion, given the significance of mental health issues as well. So I sincerely hope that February the 10th is not too soon for the Education Minister, because this issue, as members have rightly set out, is immediate and is real and is of deep concern to children and families across Northern Ireland. Okay, members content to move on? Okay, thank you. Agenda item 2.4, members, is our committee motion on the adverse impact of the pandemic on access to special educational needs support, which was debated yesterday by the Assembly. Can I thank all members for their contributions. Do members wish to propose any further actions to follow up on the motion? I would suggest that we write to the Education Minister to seek a detailed update with regards to the establishment of a Vulnerable Children Reference Group, which would bring Department of Education, Department of Health, special school leaders, school SEN leaders, and parents and families together to ensure that there are proper contingency plans in place for the support of children with special educational needs. at this time, but also suggest that we write to the Minister to ask what funding is being put in place comparable to the Engage programme for special schools. Any other members wish to add actions further to that motion yesterday?
Yeah, Chair, can we ask the Minister for an update in terms of the prioritisation of the vaccination of special school teachers and teachers and staff?
Absolutely. I was raised on multiple occasions in the Chamber yesterday by our motion and question time, so I'd be glad to agree to that, Justin. Members, Chair, have any other actions yet? Mark, go ahead there.
Chair, I have great concern about the vaccination programme. And I think it's vital that we ask the Minister to engage with the Health Minister to take this forward, because the Health Minister will actually get out the timetable. So we need the engagement from the Health Minister as well. And I would fully agree that we go for this because it's vital.
Okay, we can certainly follow that up. Obviously, the committee has already written to both the Education Minister and the Health Minister to ask how education staff will be prioritised. To support the prioritisation. Clark, do you wish to come in there?
Yeah, just those two items were in the chairperson's business, because they have been largely dealt with. So the youth groups letter said that JCVI have indicated that the second phase of vaccination could be focused on further preventing hospitalisation through occupational vaccinations. The Minister has written to the Minister for Health to ask that all educational staff are prioritised for vaccinations, and I have noted the committee's further actions for post-primary transfer, but that wee letter was just to say that the committee had asked for arrangements in respect of safety and track and trace at transfer testing centres, and because there is no transfer test, those arrangements are no longer necessary, and there will not be a reply on that.
Yeah, no, that's helpful clarification that it was about a very discreet aspect of the post-primary transfer process in relation to testing at centres, rather than the wider issue that of which we do still have multiple concerns. Okay, anyone else want to add actions further to the motion on special educational needs provision? Content? Okay. Could I, members, another issue is being raised with me reasonably widely, and that's whether the department is given any consideration or scoping to the viability of offering pupils the option of repeating the school academic year. I don't know if that's been raised with any other members, but would members be content for me to write on behalf of the committee to the Education Minister to ask if there is any consideration or scoping being given to that option?
Yes, Chair, I've also been contacted by a number of people, so I would be happy with that.
Okay.
Happy here, Chair. I mean, one woman contacted me and said it was her child who wants to do the year again, which is totally out of character for her.
Yeah, no, obviously they're a fair few logistical challenges, but the National Children's Bureau had written in relation to this matter in the previous academic year, and the NEU Teaching Union had also provided us with some information with regards to how other jurisdictions make use of this type of approach in other stages of education as well. So I think it would be timely for us to write and at least ask what consideration is being given, or what scoping has been conducted in relation to that particular proposal. Members content with that?
Sure. How does that work? You mentioned logistically. How does that work if half a year decide they want to repeat the year?
There are undoubtedly logistical challenges. There's also challenges at entry level stages of education as well. Justin, early years, nursery, movement to university and things like that. So I think in the first instance, to be fair to the department, it would be a question to ask if any scoping has been given to it. And indeed, it's a matter that we could take further evidence on as well. As I say, National Children's Bureau had conducted work in relation to it. So maybe see what response we get from the department, and then in forward work programme, perhaps consider whether we take some evidence on that matter ourselves. They'll allow questions like that to be scoped. Fair enough. Okay, thank you. Okay, that's almost chairperson's business. Deputy Chair, can I ask if am I right in saying that this is potentially your last meeting with us? Hopefully I'm not speaking out of turn in that regard, am I?
No, you're right. This is my last meeting.
Okay, well, on that note, could I say a very sincere thank you on behalf of the Education Committee to you for your service to the Education Committee? I know I did so yesterday in the Chamber, but you've worked tirelessly and advocated on a wide range of extremely important education issues. I mentioned yesterday free school meals, youth services, and many, many issues. And you've been an effective advocate for our children and young people. So we thank you for that service, and we wish you well in your new committee placement. I believe is potentially with, has that been announced? Am I allowed to refer to that?
Yes.
Yeah. You're with the Communities Committee, I think it is. So you'll still be working for children and young people and the wider community on a wide range of issues there. So we wish you well for that, Karen.
Thank you, Chair. And as I said yesterday, it has been a privilege to work in education, and I really enjoyed my time on the committee with you all. I think, you know, this committee works really well, and everybody is working for children and young people very, very hard. But I also want to thank you, Chair, for the support that you've given me throughout the role. It was all new to myself, so thank you very much for that, and the best wishes. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Karen. Okay, members, then move on to agenda item 3, draft minutes. Can I refer members to draft minutes of the committee meeting of 20th of January, at page 8 of your meeting packs, and seek members' agreement that the minutes are a complete and accurate record of proceedings. Agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. Okay, agenda item 4, matters arising. Any matters arising? Daniel, sorry you missed chairperson's business there. I realise that was because of connectivity issues. Are there any, I'll give you a quick opportunity, whether there are any matters from chairperson's business that you might have wished to refer to. We agreed a number of actions further to the same motion that we presented yesterday, seeking an update on the Vulnerable Children Reference Group comparable engaged programme funding for special schools, priority vaccinisation of staff. I think you'd maybe mentioned a working group in your contribution yesterday. Any other issues you'd like us to write to the department about in relation to that matter?
Yeah. Thank you, Chair. I just couldn't get the thing to work. I don't know what was wrong with it there. The vaccination programme, yeah, I'm conscious you've discussed that, and I think it's an absolute must. There's a huge amount of frustration that we're hearing every day in relation to that, particularly from SEM schools. But in relation to the working group, yeah, we suggested the minister at an earlier time that there should be a working group between SEM principals and the health experts, particularly PHA, just to assess the situation in schools, because I'm not exactly sure that the PHA or the minister or someone in the Department of Education actually understand how complex and how unique the situation is in schools, and that there needs to be an individual plan for their unique needs and demands. And the only way to properly assess that is by that working group. Now, the minister has acknowledged it's a great idea, but he hasn't done anything about it. And it wouldn't be a huge effort on his part to do that.
Okay. Members content to seek an update on all those matters then? Yep, agreed.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, Justin?
And one more issue. I know there is a program which the Minister has alluded to help kids get back in track, get back on track. But some principals have told me that amounts to 6p per child per day. That's not enough. And I've raised the issue of a recharge program on multiple occasions, one that helps children bounce back academically, mentally, emotionally, re-socializes children, because some children have been locked away, not locked away literally, but metaphorically, because they haven't got access to their friends or other kids. And that they need to re-socialize. There needs to be a program to help them to adapt, and there needs to be a program to help kids catch up physically. So I want the Minister to give details of how much resource is being attributed to a total recharge program for kids to help them catch up and to maybe avoid the necessity to have children repeating years. What resources have been attributed there? What funding has been given to help kids catch up? A recharge program that's across the board, especially for kids from disadvantaged backgrounds. Can the minister give us detail on that?
Fair question, Justin. If I could supplement that, if we could write to the minister and seek a detailed breakdown of funding allocated and expended to date and what outcome, and then what additional funding is going to be allocated for those items that you're referring to, Justin. Is that fair enough?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, Clark.
Also, your witnesses now might be able to help you with some of that.
Certainly. We'll have the budget briefing coming up. Okay, members, we'll go to agenda item 5 then, our departmental briefing on the budget. Can I ask Assembly Broadcasting to remove all members from the spotlight and to add our witnesses? Can I refer members to a briefing note from the clerk at page 15, correspondence from the Committee for Finance regarding the draft budget at page 21, a departmental briefing paper at page 13 of table papers, and a briefing paper from the Construction Employers Federation on the draft 21-22 Northern Ireland Executive Budget at page 33 of tabled papers. Can I welcome Mr. Gary Fair, Director of Finance at the Department of Education, Stephen Van Houten, the Department Deputy Finance Director, and Philip Irwin, Director of Investment and Infrastructure at the Department. Can I advise witnesses that the committee will give you 10 minutes to make an opening statement and follow this with questions from members, which can be answered across the panel of witnesses. Can I ask Assembly Broadcasting to keep the witnesses in the spotlight and to bring members into the spotlight when they're asking questions? Okay. Gary, you okay to kick us off?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can you hear me okay, everybody?
I can, yes. Thank you.
Yes, that's perfect. Thank you very much for inviting us along this morning. As you know, we forwarded a couple of papers, one on the in-year position and one on next year's position. I was going to propose just talking through those within the time you've allocated us. You're happy
with that? Thank you.
I'll talk through both this year and next year, and then I can take any questions. And obviously, Philip can pick up on any specific capital questions. So, and I'm not sure of the paper number there that you have, but the January monitoring round position. Just the starting point for the January monitoring round was obviously the outcome of the October monitoring round, where we had originally highlighted significant pressure, 69.7 million, to the Department of Finance. Well, while none of these pressures were addressed in full, 11.8 million, as you can see from Table 1, was allocated to the department to address specific pressures. 11.8 for a large part of that 11.8 was for SEN actually in year, and the remainder for maintenance, school maintenance. So there were residual unfunded pressures. In addition, under the COVID response and COVID restart headings, we had bid for pressures of 46.7 million and 26.8 million respectively at October monitoring, and all of those pressures were met, and those are actually detailed in tab one. And that tab one actually includes a lot of the detail that may, you know, within that would probably answer the last question that was asked there about the amount of money that has been invested specifically to help children out in the midst of all this. So for January monitoring, there was a review of all of the pressures, and the residual pressures were then highlighted in table one. So following a review by the Education Authority and within the department, the EA's position has actually been reassessed, and their residual pressure shown in table one of 13.2 has actually reduced to 4 million. Now, just to give you a bit of context, I think everybody knew that given the amount of money that was being poured into the system under the COVID response and COVID restart headings, that was going to have an overall positive impact across schools, with a combination of schools while being open with schools, with children not attending, a lot of children not attending, that there were reduced costs, obviously, and additional money going in specifically to help out in the current pandemic. So it's been a combination of factors that have unusually led this year to the EA forecasting a much better position by year end. So that 4 million pressure has been identified as the residual amount, and the minister had sufficient within his budget to cover that. And just by way of a reminder, I think I briefed you the last time I was up, the minister had set aside at the start of the year certain amounts, given the crisis that we're in the middle of. He'd set aside 8 million for the substitute teachers hardship fund, 8 million to support families in receipt of free school meals, 0.8 million to address emerging pressure in respect of DGGMI school canteen lost income, 1.6 million to address emerging pressures in SEA as a result of the exams being cancelled, and 1.7 million for EA pressures. So the minister has had a certain amount held back. And when I refer to elements at January monitoring being met from within the minister's budget, that's the reason behind that. There were certain contingencies held back, and we have been able to secure some those amounts and some other amounts, we've been able to secure some flexibility from the Department of Finance to move those around for other purposes. Teaching and non-teaching pay pressures, as you know, is always an issue that is highlighted as a significant pressure for the sector. Obviously, the negotiations are ongoing with the unions. The pay agreements that have currently been agreed and the arrears have been paid out relate to the 2017 and 2018 years. So whilst there are still pressures because of the overall position that is being forecast across the sector, we didn't bid for them because there wasn't a requirement. The extra money that has gone into the system has been absorbed that pressure. School maintenance is always an issue that we raise. Basically, at the start of every year, there's an estimated amount that is required, and we haven't been able to allocate that full amount. So there's still a pressure. The EA has identified a pressure of 1.2 million, which again, the minister can meet out of his budget. Delivery of the childcare strategy, there's still preliminary work ongoing, and that's really what's referred to there as the additional pressure, again, that the minister has been able to meet. Obviously, there's no executive agreement on taking that forward fully, but there's certainly been preliminary work taken forward. And there's an estimated rates pressure as a result of a significant increase in rates across the sector, which has now been removed because the EA has been able to absorb that. Voluntary exit scheme costs have basically the focus this year in terms of the voluntary exit scheme has been on what is purely essential in terms of closures or school amalgamations or SEN related changes to requirements. So that again, this pressure has been funded out of the department's resource budget. The new decade, new approach commitments. I think I advised you the last time, out of the 13 million that was originally estimated as inescapable pressures, 1 million was allocated out of the minister's budget at the start of the year. And that is deemed to be sufficient given the difficulties with the COVID pandemic of actually taking a lot of that stuff forward. And there's a small departmental staffing pressure that has been met out of our own budget. The Educational Transformation Programme was put on hold at the start of the pandemic, and some of the staff were moved on to the Schools Restart project. So there's a small pressure there in relation to that, which again will be met out of the department's contingency. SEA has identified a new inescapable pressure of 1.5 million relating to the unprecedented disruption to its services as it responds to the pandemic. The additional funding is required to address reduced income, legal advice, statistician posts, supplier costs, etc. And there's some other small inescapable pressures as well, which have been able to meet out of the budget. And a number of capital pressures that have been bid for, and the bid has been met at 18 million. Philip can pick up on any detail relating to that if need be. So in terms of the summary of the pressures, you can see from table 3, we've gone through them there, it's a total of 7.7 million. And those have, as I've said, those were met out of what we already held within the department. so we didn't have to bid for those to Department of Finance. There was a significant resource reduced requirement. Now, this is specifically relating to the build-up of school surpluses, and this was agreed by the executive some years ago, that where school surpluses were increasing, that those amounts, the increased amount, could be banked by the Department of Finance for future drawdown by schools. So that provides schools in that position with some flexibility to draw that money down in future years. So that's what that 16 odd million relates to. Whilst it's a reduced requirement, it's quite specific. It's different to any other kind of reduced requirement. And then there were some capital easements noted as well, an easement of 5 million against the ring-fenced Fresh Start Agreement funding, and some excess receipts of 1.3 million that there wasn't cover for. And then in terms of the COVID response pressures, the department carried out a further assessment of the remaining COVID-19 response pressures at January monitoring. Following that assessment, there was a net pressure of 2.1 million relating to existing pressures that had previously been identified and unmet. So that brought it down to 2.1 million. That particular pressure, again, we had sufficient in within the department's budget to meet that. Now, because there were sort of the over and under spends against some of the specific COVID-related allocations, and as you'll understand, as with all departments, any money that is specifically allocated for COVID purposes comes under certain headings, and departments are required to monitor expenditure against those headings. So that monitoring process has been carried out, and a lot of this obviously was handled by the Education Authority. And you'll see from Table 5 that the new bids that were submitted were 11.9 million. Now, there's 4.3 of that, the holiday pay accrual, which relates basically to the fact that because a number of people, number of staff have been so embroiled in dealing with the crisis, they haven't been able to take their normal annual leave entitlement. So that creates a cost next year in terms of an accrual. Now, that 4.3 million, as with other departments, was met centrally. So that reduced the amount that we effectively had to bid for to 7.6 million, which is the amount you would have seen referred to in the Finance Minister's oral statement as the amount that was allocated. Now, there were also some reduced requirements against previous COVID and restart allocations, as you see from Table 6. So basically the net easement really, it works out at 3.8 million to the Department of Finance. And we have the 7.7 million bid met. There's obviously a lot of detail underpinning this within the tab one in particular, gives an outline of all the money that has been allocated. You can see from that a total of 97 odd million for a restart and 106 million for COVID-related responses. So there has been a considerable amount of money gone in over the course of the year. And it has obviously been challenging in itself because a lot of these, as I've said, came in a ring-fenced manner where earmarked budgets that had to be carefully monitored against. That has been a challenge in itself for the department and the Education Authority, but it has been handled appropriately. So in turn, moving on to next year's budget, as you will recall, we responded to a Department of Finance information gathering exercise in the last quarter in the previous quarter, and we submitted what we believed to be our inescapable and other pressures at that point in time for the following 3 years. Now, the Chancellor's spending review outcome announced on 25th of November only provided for 1 year again, so we're now focused on next year alone. Now, the main change since the previous briefing that I gave committee is, you will note in paragraph 4 that there's an increase of about 41.1 million to our baseline. That specifically relates to an additional 30.6 million that has been included in our baseline for holiday hunger for next year, and 10 million for SEM, and 0.5 million for some EU matching funding that would normally have been handled in year. So that's the main change. As you can see from table 1, we were asked to categorise our bids under certain headings. There were general pressures, and tab one gives the detail on those. COVID-19 related pressures, 73.7 million, and then new decade, new approach pressures. And essentially that refers to the commitments within the new decade, new approach agreement that we do not believe we're fully funded for. And that includes, for example, the ongoing impact of the previous pay settlement for teachers. Previously anticipated resource Dell savings, particularly in relation to transport, haven't actually, we don't reckon that those will be delivered next year. So they've been removed from the picture. And transformation, departments were asked separately to identify what costs would be required for transformation for next year. So as you can see from table two, our costs are in the region of about 3.7 million, we estimate. And that's purely just to take forward the programme, which has been stalled this year. So it's programme management costs, not the cost of actually delivering transformation and whatever recommendations come out of that. Now, we weren't asked for other pressures, but as I advised the committee before, we did identify a number of general education pressures that don't fall necessarily within the Department of Finance's definition of inescapable, contractual. And you can see those are listed below. Now, this was at a point in time, so certain things have probably moved on from there. For example, period poverty that I know the committee was interested in before. Just to advise you that the EA is currently procuring that, taking that forward with the aim of having the period poverty measures fully in place by September 2021.
Guy, what table is this one?
That's on table three of the budget paper, but next year's budget paper.
Okay.
So there may be some costs next year, but the main cost will be the following year once everything is implemented. So we've identified a number of costs there. Any potential teaching pay awards moving forward, which haven't been accounted for, obviously, because negotiations are still ongoing with the unions. And obviously, the executive has to give consideration next year to whether or not to adopt the pay freeze that was announced by the Chancellor. I'll not go through all those, but you see under the various headings some of those issues that we have identified. It roughly coincides with our COVID-19 related pressures, but it is a different set of pressures.
Yeah, if you could draw your remarks to a close shortly, Gary, thanks.
Okay, and then just very quickly to close off that paper, under capital, you can see there in table four what we had bid for and what was received. And just to draw attention to the fact, obviously, the 18 million that has been allocated this year will have an impact on the bids that were submitted for next year, because some of what was planned for next year will be brought forward into this year. And there's also currently some consideration being given by the Department of Finance to accessing RRI borrowing for next year, which could assist the positions, it could change the current position and the current allocation. So I'll maybe pause there.
Okay, thanks, Gary. Thank you. So in terms of your inescapable pressures for 21-22,
yes.
what were in total your inescapable pressures?
If you look at table one, the estimated funding gap was 137.2 million. Now, the COVID pressures, I understand there is a separate pot for next year for COVID-related funding that was in a previous finance minister's paper. So we would be fairly hopeful that the COVID pressures could be met out of that separate fund. New decade, new approach pressures, obviously, as well, are an issue. There are elements within that we consider to be inescapable. So the total funding gap or under the inescapable heading is 321 million. But as I say, we would be hopeful that the COVID pressures, which are only an estimate, obviously, at this stage, for the first few quarters of the year, and it may be that some of the new decade, new approach measures may not be able to be taken forward if the funding isn't made available, but that total of 321 million is the figure we've identified.
Okay, that's what I was going to ask you. What is the real term impact of that funding gap?
Well, it will obviously present the minister with challenges in terms of how he allocates the funding. For example, the 16.5 million confidence and supply money isn't included in our baseline. So, and now in saying that, we've been engaging, our minister has been engaging with the finance minister, and we're hopeful that we might be able to get that in a year, but that in itself, as was the case in the last few years, has been a bit of a challenge because it wasn't baselined. There will be a number of challenges, not least the usual pay pressure challenge that we face every year and which puts pressure on the sector. I think one important factor to remember, I was obviously, when I was talking about the in-year position, obviously the in-year position this year is a lot better now than it was in the last few years. As you know, that we've been emphasising the pressures on the underfunding in the sector. The reason that the position is different in year is because of the pandemic and the amount of the additional funding that has gone into the sector and school closures or pupils not attending school in a lot of instances. So the same kinds of pressures will be faced by the sector next year. Pay and price pressures and SEN, increase in SEN pressures, although we have got a 10 million towards that at this stage.
And how does that 321 million funding gap compare to funding gaps in other years?
I don't have the figures in front of me, but from recollection, it was 300 odd that we were forecasting at the start of last year. I can get you the figures if you want the specific figures, but...
Okay, and how concerned are you by the scale of that funding gap, and what are you doing to address it?
Well, we're in a similar position to previous years. I mean, we have a good relationship, our minister obviously has a good relationship with the finance minister. We have good relationships within the Department of Finance, so we're hopeful, as in previous years, that additional money could be secured in year, depending on what's available. And probably some difficult decisions, as always, will have to be made by the minister at the start of the year. And obviously, okay. The minister's focus, as always, will be on trying to avoid impacting frontline services.
The committee will be eager to know what those hard decisions are likely to be. In terms of this year's budget, briefly, before I bring other members in, what has been the total investment in the Engage programme?
Do we have that figure?
I believe the total figure is it's 11 point something million.
Okay. And has the, obviously special schools are ineligible for Engage programme funding. Has the minister bid for or allocated comparable resources to special schools for Engage programme related spending?
There's currently a business case has been developed and is going through the processes at the moment to focus on the Engage programme for special schools. So the money hasn't been spent this year, but it's hopeful that once the business case secures approval, that could progress this year and then into next year.
Okay. And is there a childcare support fund in place for January to March of this year?
Yes, there is.
Yes.
Okay, and is that likely to be rolled beyond March?
I think the position in relation to COVID-related bids is going to have to be reviewed again, obviously, as part of our budget process. I would imagine there's a lot of uncertainties, as we're all aware, in terms of where we'll stand, but yeah, it'll have to be reviewed.
Okay, I'd be keen to hear from Philip on the Fresh Start capital investment in integrated schools, but I'm out of time, so hopefully it'll come up somewhere else, and if it doesn't, I'm going to be safe with time at the end for that, Philip. But can I bring in Deputy Chairperson Karen Mullen, MLA?
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Gary, for that update. Again, it's great to see you. And it's really welcome to hear the progression, Gary, from the last time you ran. I know I had said, even seeing it in paper at that stage, but the progression we've made in relation to the period poverty also holiday hunger, and taking forward a private members bill and tackling holiday hunger. So I welcome that. Just to follow on there, the chair had from the chair in terms of engaging that, I do welcome, and I seen in the pack there was a small allocation COVID bid for that extra funding to support special schools and language-based learning. But I also seen in table six there was around the easement. There was not three million that was handed back in relation to the under the heading of supporting children and learning. Given the pressures that's there and the need for more money, just would there be any rationale why that was handed back?
I think with all of the areas listed in table six, this is basically the input that we have received from the sector, from the Education Authority and schools, that was all that they were able to spend. Or sorry, that was a small shortfall in what they were able to spend. I think it's just probably been the practicalities to some extent, because things have been changing so much throughout the year. It has obviously been challenging for schools on occasions to spend out on all of these specific funds, but it's not to say that a lot isn't being taken forward.
Yeah, and Gary, I know Stephen would give the update there, just following on again from the Engage in relation to what we had got. And we knew even at that stage it wasn't going to be enough. We know that there's more COVID money there. The Finance Minister has asked for further bids. And I see you did give an update in relation to a further bid for Engage for the next financial year. But at the minute, is there a bid in around that COVID money for more around Engage?
The figures that we have quoted in table five of, sorry, will I get the right table here? Table one of the budget paper refers to the COVID pressures of 73.7. Now, that was at a point in time, the end of last calendar year. So we would need to review those again. And the likes of the Engage programme will be identified as a bid and a pressure that will need to be met. So I think we need to look at it. And because things have been changing so much, the Minister's going to have a review really exactly what his requirements might be.
Yeah.
And it may be on a quarter or a two-quarter basis, given the uncertainty around where things can land.
Thank you, Gary. I know this is something that we've all been under the Minister about, and we will continue, because obviously the Engage was there at a period when we were coming back even in September, and we've had further disruption. So any more funds and to helping our children catch up and support their learning will be welcome. So we'll follow up with the Minister. Just in relation to, you touched on the voluntary exit scheme and the change for this year, and that it was purely essential. You had outlined there. See, for next year's budget, will the voluntary exit scheme go back to full implementation pre-COVID?
At this stage, we have made the assumption that it won't, because the advice we have at this stage from the Department of Finance, that the position would be the same, that it would purely be the minimal amount.
Right.
So we'll obviously keep the committee advised if that changes, but that's what's been factored in at this stage, about 3 million for next year.
So Gary, you would know the real pressures that this will place on some schools. And I had wrote to the Minister about last year's scheme and the pressures that was there, and it brings me on to my final question, Chair, and it was just around school budgets, Gary, and you did touch on it. And I suppose, unfortunately, before COVID and coming back on the mandate last year and the commitments made, we had hoped to see an increase in school budgets. Can you give us any idea, will there be any increase, or how funding is being prioritised to support school budgets in the coming year?
Yeah, I can't give you specifics, obviously, at this stage, because it'll be up to the Minister. We're sort of working through the process with the Minister at this stage, really, as to how money will be allocated out of the baseline. I know it would be the Minister's intention to do all that he can, as always, to support schools, and he was able to give a bit of an increase for this year. So can't give you specifics, only to assure you that I know that the Minister is minded to do what he can, but it's a tight budget settlement. So You know, one of the things that we did this year was we made sure that the AWPU values were remained at the previous year's level. So again, that would be something we would hope to propose to the minister if it's affordable. So it's just a matter of really working through, because you can see there's quite a number of unfunded inescapable pressures. So they're really difficult choices for the minister.
Great. Thank you, Gary Chair. That's me. Thank you.
Thanks, Karen. Just over 5 minutes, extremely helpful. Thank you, Karen. Just to remind members, given the nature of our session today, we have roughly 5 minutes per member for their question and answers from the witnesses. Can I bring in Daniel McCrossan, MLA? Daniel? No? Okay. Can I bring in William Humphrey, MLA?
Morning. Thank you very much, Chair. Gary, thanks very much. I'm afraid that's the sort of the realpolitik that what you've outlined for us this morning is the realpolitik of the situation we face financially. And as you say, a number of tough decisions have been made. So I guess it's like some of the questions I'm going to ask you about how we, you know, mitigate against those and work collaboratively across government to reduce those pressures. You said as part of your presentation that the minister has been meeting with the finance minister about monies, and that your department has a good relationship with the Department of Finance. So can I ask you to go a wee bit further and maybe put a wee bit more meat on the bones and tell us, you know, when we're likely to find out around these things, about these extra monies, if they're potentially there?
When I say there's a good relationship, I think what I was referring to was our anticipation in advance of each year that we will hopefully do reasonably well out of in-year monitoring rounds. And again, that position won't be known until the new financial year begins. But we have a very open relationship. I certainly have a very open relationship with Department of Finance colleagues, so they know and understand our pressures very clearly. And that certainly helps when it comes to assessing bids when they come through. But I think it's just that it's we have to go through the normal process, transparent process, but at least there is a clear understanding of what the pressures are. And I think the committee has been very helpful in the past as well, highlighting the pressures that are on the sector, which assists us when we're engaging and when the minister's engaging at executive level. So it's that in-year process I'm primarily focused on. Unless there are substantial changes, which is highly likely at that at this stage, to the Northern Ireland Bloc grant allocation, it's highly unlikely there's going to be any significant change to the budget set at our baseline. So it's really just that reliance on the in-year monitoring process that's important for us now.
But Gary, when you say about the pressures and any other years, second only to health, everyone out there knows the pressures that are on the Department of Education and the Minister in particular. So there should be no need for government, particularly the Finance Minister, to have that issue reinforced because of the very understandable pressures that schools are under because of the implications that have unfolded from COVID. I mean, part of my question was, have you got any indication of when you're going to know? You don't, or because that wasn't part of your answer.
Well, we know we have been given the budget settlement for next year. And when I'm referring to our finance minister, our minister's engagement with the finance minister, that's the same with every department. There needs to be that level of engagement on budget. In terms of timing of any additional money, that would form part of the in-year monitoring process. And the first monitoring round, if everything goes as planned, would be the June monitoring round. So at the moment, the minister will have to, in due course, make decisions on how he allocates the baseline that he's been given. And then beyond that, we will continue to highlight pressures as part of the normal monitoring round. Now, I don't know whether this coming year, in the first few months at least, whether they'll be the same. This year, there were additional opportunities to bid for COVID-related money and restart-related money. So I don't know how that will be handled next year, but certainly every opportunity that there is, we will be putting a good case to the Department of Finance.
No, thanks. And as I say, the Finance Minister should be well aware, because as I say, second only to health, education is under the most pressure. One of the issues that was discussed during the debate yesterday was the issue about remote learning and blended learning, as it's been called. And blended learning, remote learning will work where the technology is available. Last week, I mentioned in my contribution yesterday, I was contacted by a school principal in my area. And my constituency is one of the most deprived, not just Northern Ireland, but the United Kingdom. She didn't have enough iPads for the young people in her care. Now, is there work ongoing? Because I don't think that's something which is the sole responsibility of the Department of Education. Is there ongoing work across government with the likes of the Department of Communities and local government? Because I know Belfast City Council was also helpful in the Belfast area to try and address this issue of the technology not being available. Because if we have an ongoing problem of schools being closed, this is going to be crucial.
William, just briefly to interject, that's 5 minutes, by the way. All right. So, Gary, go ahead and give your answer there. Thanks, William.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, could I just pass over to Philip on that point, please?
Thanks, Philip.
I'm not aware of what work is going on in the background in regard to other departments, but there is a lot of work has happened over the last number of weeks in terms of putting together the case and procuring additional devices. So, I mean, my understanding is if we look back over the last year look at the number of devices that have been put out and the number of devices that have been procured ready to be issued to schools, that we're getting up to something close to 30,000 devices. So principals have the opportunity to request devices from the EA. My understanding is that devices are there and will be there to supply that. There might be an issue just in terms of the logistics of getting that number of devices out to schools, but there is a lot of work and a lot of activity at the moment. And you know, there shouldn't be the business case has been put together on the basis of the demand coming from the principals, so there should be devices there to satisfy that demand.
Okay, thank you, Phil. Can I try Daniel McCrossan again?
Yes, Chair. Thank you.
Thanks, Daniel. 5 minutes. Thank you.
As soon as it connected, it cut off before this thing is not that reliable. Thanks, Gary, for your presentation. I'll go straight into it. Just a bit of a brief point following on from Karen Mullen. I've raised concerns in relation to the Engage programme. I'm conscious that since it was allocated this year, quite a lot of schooling hasn't happened on the school estate. But I'm just wondering, how much was allocated in total and how much was spent, and what's going to happen at the turn of the financial year? Is this money ring-fenced or is it going to be lost?
Stephen? Yeah. In terms of how much has been made available, it's 11.2, and apologies for at the start of this saying 11 point something. 11.2 has been allocated. I would actually need to get back to you in terms of how much has been spent, because, you know, it's the EA is in the process of assessing that across 1,080 odd schools. And in terms of the Engage program will be a bit tricky because if the schools are spending the money on something aside from teachers that they can specifically identify as Engage funding, it might be a little bit tricky in terms of the way the EA's normal earmarked funding works. One of the issues we do have probably this year is that the way we're being asked to treat the COVID funding is probably, it will be a lot more rigorous and subject to a lot greater scrutiny than our normal earmarking, because the normal earmark funds, the schools get it year on year, they know what they're going to do with it, whereas with the COVID money, it's all new, and the money they got at the start of the year was based on a point in time, and then we've gone through this year where it's been very, very, very fluid. So to be perfectly honest, I probably can't, sorry to take 5 minutes to say I can't answer your question, but it's probably a question we need to answer at the end of the year as opposed to right now.
Yeah, but if there is huge funds left over, it's likely that that will be returned. It won't be able to be kept. Peter Weir has already confirmed that. I'm just checking if you knew that, but it's fine. But I just want to cut across to another few points. The overall DE budget position trend is alarming. A mere 1.8% increase. This leaves an estimated funding gap of $321.3 million, as Gary's referred to, for 2021-22 for costs. I know we have had this conversation before, but what does the DE propose to do to help schools meet their pupils' growing needs with what is effectively, in real terms, less resources than the previous year?
I think it's just the usual challenge, as I said, that the Minister will have to review what he can do from within his baseline. Now, as has already been referred to, there is quite a significant pot for next year for COVID-related issues. So we're hopeful that additional money going in specifically to provide that extra support to pupils will also help in the coming year. But obviously, all of that, as you know, has to be monitored separately. But it still has an overall beneficial effect on the finances of the sector, as we've seen this year.
Yeah, yeah. So I was about to ask, is there any other potential sources? So you have more or less funding. So you've more or less answered that. There is an expectation that there will be funding available for next year. But see, in relation to what has been confirmed on the media and public this week, the $300 million sitting of COVID monies at the centre with the finance minister, is it the case that you won't bid for that because it's impossible to spend that before the turn of the financial year? Therefore, it would make it highly likely that money won't be spent.
Well, we have bid for all that we could have bid for throughout the year. And as you can see from tab one, it's a significant amount of additional resources that we've got. We actually gave up very little of that in this monitoring round. So, you know, we've been working as closely as possible. As you'll understand, it's challenging for schools, for example, as well, when they get extra resources, because it gives them more work having to monitor additional types of expenditure that's for very specific purposes. So, and I think to be fair on all departments at the start of the year, everything moved so quickly and departments were very quickly assessing what they might need for certain purposes to help out in the midst of the pandemic, and it has been probably quite challenging.
So Gary, on that basis, if you rewind the clock slightly to bids that were made earlier in the year, how far short was the allocation to the Department for Education from the Department of Finance? So you bid X, what did you actually get?
Well, throughout the year, we got everything that we'd asked for.
Everything. So
it was eventually confirmed in the October monitoring round. I mean, that's when all of the revised bids were met. So we weren't short.
I would be frustrated to hear that you had requested extra resources and funds and didn't receive it. Now there's $300 million sitting at the centre. That would be an unforgivable situation. So I'm glad you confirmed that's not the case.
Yeah. I was just going to say there were maybe time delays in terms of the bids, but that was more the issues of Department of Finance securing additional resources for Northern Ireland. But nothing was held. We got all that we needed.
Daniel, that's 5 minutes if you can draw your marks to a close there.
Thank you, Guy. Time delays, unfortunately, is something that storm ministers are very good at. It'd be far better if they got this stuff out quicker and we wouldn't have such huge sums of money lying at the centre. A final point, Chair, I really need this answer. There's a suggestion to reduce transport costs, and as you can imagine, Guy, this is something that will alarm me as a rural a member of the Assembly. How could this be achieved without effectively imposing what would amount to an additional tax on people who live in rural areas who will have to pick up that cost as a result of the cut or proposed cut from the department?
I wouldn't have any specifics on that to be able to answer you, to be honest. Sorry, just to pick up on your previous point in terms of, I suppose give credit to the Department of Finance colleagues, because I know that they did all that they could throughout the year to secure the money as quickly as possible.
Okay. Thanks, Daniel. I realise we're short for time today. Can I just say briefly that there does appear to be a concerning lack of in-year monitoring of the expenditure and outcomes on the Engage programme, and I think that's something that we might want to come back to. But can I bring in Robbie Butler, MLA, please?
Yep. Okay, Chair. That's me.
Thanks, Robbie.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you guys for your presentation. I hope to not take up the 5 minutes. Last week we did talk to the unions and they did remind us, as if we didn't need reminded, of the historic underinvestment in schools across the state. Also, we have to factor in the 3 years that we with no ministerial lead. And then when you look at the problems the schools are facing, it's not hard to understand the difficulties that are compounded at this time through COVID. They also spoke about the recovery funding, and you, Gary, have alluded to that post-COVID and the increased budget perhaps for next year. Speaking specifically about IT and sort of that future-proofing, that has any bidding or budgeting been done in respect of that post-COVID recovery and infrastructure piece, which specifically looks at IT and utilising some of the devices that are, but stepping forward into a fit for purpose 21st century education system?
I think probably what you're referring to is being picked up in the current process that the Education Authority is going through to develop and procure a C2K replacement. It's not exactly a C2K replacement, but as you say, it will be something that is future-proofed to take account of the points that you make there. So I think it's more, and that is also taking account of the potential fallout of the current pandemic that will have to be factored in looking to the future. So I think that's the mechanism by which that's been picked up.
Okay, no, that's fine. I'm sure that, I know across the committee, a lot of us are sort of exercised and engaged in some platforms that might be useful, including Seesaw, where we had a meeting last week, but we'll discuss that later on. Gary, I'm not sure if this would be more for the Minister, by the way, this next question, as opposed to you, but I'm hoping you could shed some light on it. Okay, so we know about the Engage funding. We've been putting pressure on the Minister with regard to SEN and special schools, but nursery schools, perhaps, is it fair to say that they have missed out on any additional support and finance? I'm not aware of any that would mirror something like the Engage programme for nursery schools.
I don't think I could respond on the specifics. The only point I would make is that at various junctures throughout the year, we have certainly gone out and through the Education Authority gone out and sought bids right across the sector. So where issues were raised, very careful consideration was given to them. And you know, we certainly haven't held back on bidding when there was an identified need. So I don't know, that probably doesn't answer your question because I'm not familiar with the specifics, but
yeah, that's okay.
Certainly.
Yeah, hopefully it'll be picked up maybe in the, just even through the question that maybe somebody will respond to that, just and it'll be certainly a wee marker. But I appreciate that, Gary, and it's probably more a ministerial question. So listen, no points lost for that. I noted that you did say to one of the members there very little in terms of money returned, and that is good, and that should be the case for every department, so that's commendable. But with regard to ensuring that there are no further monies put at risk, has the department developed sort of a priority list of capital projects which can be delivered in year to obviously to build into the state, but also to mitigate against any risk of losing any money that can be spent?
I'll pass over to Philip on that.
Yeah, when far from giving money back, in that monitoring round, we have bid for an additional 18.1 million, the vast majority of which related to minor works, and that bid was successful. I think our issue will be, I mean, that would be an unprecedented size of bid for this time of the year. You know, the biggest I have probably seen at any time in this sort of monitoring round would be a couple of million, where you can bring additional works forward from next year. So that's a significant programme. I think the risk will be we've asked for more than we're going to be able to deliver, but you know, we're going to do our best to invest all of that additional £15 million in minor works, 15 of the 18 in minor works between now and the end of the year. But you'll appreciate to get works designed, procured and delivered before the end of March is difficult, and spending all of that money may be difficult. But you know, when the money was there, we actually upped the bid that we had initially put together when we were told that there was a possibility of additional capital being available. You know, all of that bid, as I say, was met, and we'll hopefully deliver on all of it, or certainly on most of it.
Brilliant, Philip. And final question, Chair, if that's okay. It's just to look at table four. Table 4, it shows the executive capital programs, 189.5 million against the allocation of 146. Fresh start capital, 18.7 against 11.5. So there is a deficit in that table, and I know you'll be able to explain it to me well, but there must be a risk in there somewhere. There must be something which is, the bid has been made and it doesn't match up. There must be some shortfall in some way in terms of allocation. So what does that actually mean, Philip?
Yeah, well, that is true. I suppose to make the first point that Gary made earlier, the 199 was prepared prior to the 18 million bid being, the 18 million monitoring round bid being met. So we will bring forward, if you like, some of the what was specified in the 199 into this year, hopefully, so that it would reduce the 50-odd million pound deficit. I would also say the 199 was built on the basis of every capital programme that we have running exactly to plan without any hitch. That's unlikely to happen. So there will be probably some slippage in that. But having said that, there still is a going to be a shortfall there. The other thing that we are doing and to try and mitigate that is we're working with DOF around the possibility of some additional RRI borrowing money that could be allocated to the department in next year. Now, not every project will be eligible for that. There are certain rules around it, so there's a little piece of work that we're going to have to do to identify which projects that may be eligible. But we hope to be able to fill that deficit, or certainly a lot of it, with maybe an additional bid for RRI borrowing.
Brilliant. Okay. Thank you for that. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Robbie. Thanks. Can I bring in Nicola Brogan, MLA?
Thank you, Chair. And thanks everyone for their debriefings today. I'm just going to touch on something that the Chair has already touched upon at the beginning. It's about the childcare, the support for them. I've engaged with a lot of childcare providers in the last number of weeks, and it's clear that they have faced huge challenges during COVID. Many of the providers are registered charities and have been able to fundraise as a result of the restrictions. And many are operating on a reduced capacity because of staffing levels and safety restrictions, obviously. So they might not even be covering their own costs. And then finally, parents have had to pay fees for childcare they can't even access as well. So I know you've said that there is funds for January to March of 2021. Can you just provide any more details of exactly what will be available, or what other funding bids you've put forward for additional support for childcare providers, please?
For next year, you're referring to, I presume, how it will be handled. I think with all of the table three in the paper, table three in the paper identifies the COVID-related pressures that we highlighted at a different point in time. Those will all have to be examined again on the basis, because obviously when this was originally submitted to the Department of Finance, we didn't know that we would be in the position we're in now. I'm not quite sure what position we'll be in at the start of the new financial year. So the Minister's going to have to review everything, really, including support for the childcare sector, as part of his considerations for next year. Now, in saying that, we are at least hopeful that this pot of money that's set aside for next year for COVID-related matters, we should be able to access that as required. So we'll be putting forward a bid as required. So it'll be up to the Minister to take a view closer to the time. We're working that through. We'll be working that through with them over the next few weeks. So it'll not be forgotten about issues like that.
Obviously, I think everyone knows it's very important. As I say, childcare sector has been hit very hard throughout the pandemic. Just finally, you made a point, Ryan, at the beginning as well, about the childcare strategy, and it has been delayed because of COVID too. So I'd just like to make a point that I think the Minister should prioritise that this year. Again, obviously very important for our children and young people. But that's me, Chair. Thank you.
Thanks, Nicola. Absolutely, really important points. Has a budget been allocated for the childcare strategy, Gary?
No, the issue really there is it will be dependent on, I suppose, an executive agreement, and then it'll have to be considered and among all other bids.
Okay, that remains a going concern. Can I bring in Justin McNulty, MLA? Thanks. Thanks, Justin. 5 minutes.
Hey, Gary, Philip, Stephen. Guys, what do you intend to do to address the 321 million funding pressures, which are a 14% uplift on baseline? What do you intend to do to address those?
Well, as I was saying, I suppose that there are going to be difficult decisions for the Minister to make in terms of the baseline that he has been given. So we'll be working with the Minister over the next few weeks to discuss those. We'll be continuing to engage with the Department of Finance, looking at next year to see what bids we can submit under the COVID heading. Again, depending on how the lie of the land looks at a certain point in time. And we will be continuing to engage the Department of Finance throughout next year as part of the in-year monitoring process, submitting bids as required to try and address shortfalls. So, a similar position to previous years, we just have to keep putting the case forward. But obviously, there's only a certain amount of resources available at this point in time. Minister has to plan on how he will use those. And then we will highlight pressures throughout the year. And we have been successful this year and in previous years getting additional resources. So it doesn't take away the challenge. There are significant challenges again this coming year, as has been the case in previous years.
Okay, you've talked about the Engage programme, guys. Tell me more about the Engage programme and about the money attributed to that programme and what that actually materialises to on the ground for school, for pupil, per day, per week. Tell me what the Engage programme actually means in terms of money output per school, per pupil, on the ground.
In terms of outcomes, as Stephen was saying, that would be better known come the end of the year. But the intention behind the programme is to provide an appropriately differentiated programme for childcare, child-centred, one-to-one, small group and or team teaching support to pupils of all abilities, whose schools identify as those who would benefit from additional support to engage with learning following the COVID period of lockdown. It aims to support pupils to increase their confidence, engagement, motivation to learn, and to develop the tools and skills they require to become independent learners. It aims to develop and enhance pupils' skills, knowledge and understanding in the key cross-curricular skills of using mathematics, communication, and using ICT. It aims to support and enhance pupils' development of the whole curriculum thinking skills and personal capabilities. And it aims to develop pupils' understanding of how they learn and their self-knowledge about explicit strategies. So those are the kind of specifics. So it's very, I suppose it's seeking to address a lot of the concerns around where many pupils have ended up as a result of the pandemic. Okay. And to really support those youngsters.
Listen, I like the sound of that. This all sounds very positive, and something that certainly that we should be seeking to do to help kids catch up. But tell me how that can be achieved with 6p per child per day in one specific school.
Well, I'm not sure about the 6p, but the additional money that is going into schools, among other allocations that have been given to schools, are all intended to enable teachers to provide that additional support to these children. So it is probably, it is combined with other measures that are being taken through the teacher's own professionalism. Now, how they will report on that, that's up to schools to report at a later point. You know what the impact of that is. I think one of the issues with some of the fact that there have been quite a number of earmarked funds to support young children and young people over the last lot of months, it's a combination of factors that will produce certain outcomes. So it can be difficult. It will probably be difficult to identify exactly what the specific impact of this program is. But that will obviously be done because that's part when there's a business case for anything like this. A requirement at a later stage is to do a post-project evaluation and see what the benefits are.
Okay, I know you use a number of men, but I think you'll recognise, gents, that I would struggle to understand how 6p per child per day is going to help children, help teachers really catch up after this pandemic. So I'd be very concerned about that. And I have sought for further information in terms of building a complete recharge programme to help children catch up academically, physically, emotionally, mentally, I think that's something that needs to get huge resource from the department, and from the minister needs to drive that. How much specifically has gone to schools this term in terms of the support for remote home learning?
Just to cut in, just not your 5 minutes, by the way. But go ahead, Gary, and answer that question. Thanks, Justin.
Are we able to answer that? Well,
yes, yeah, absolutely. Go ahead and answer that. Thanks.
Okay. I mean, I'm not sure I can answer your specific question then, but tab one outlines all of the different headings that money has been allocated under over the course of year. So, and for remote learning, it relates back to the answer that Philip gave in terms of the detail of the number of devices that have been procured and have been made available to youngsters as well.
In terms of capital, it's getting up to circa 10 million, just under 9 million in terms of investment in devices to be loaned out to students or to pupils through that. That's money that will be invested in this financial year.
But just very quickly, you've made the point that schools got everything they asked for. My understanding from some schools is that's not the case. So I want to make that point very firmly. Some schools feel they haven't got the support they sought for remote learning.
Yeah, to supplement that briefly, Justin, we're hearing reports that schools are being advised that the devices that they need access to might not be with them until mid to late February. That's more than halfway through the year.
Well, on that point, I mean, there has to be appropriate procurement of these devices, and there have been challenges in terms of the supply because there's been so much demand for devices right across the economy. I suppose just to refer to some specific figures, I mean, the funding that has been allocated has been 2.4 million to support the expansion of bandwidth, 2.2 million for the purchase of more Chromebooks, and 2 million for more laptops. 0.2 million for 8,000 Wi-Fi vouchers and 2,500 MiFi devices. So, I mean, there has been, you know, all the bids have been taken seriously. So, you know, where you're referring to individual schools being concerned about this, that would be a matter for them to pick up with the education authority. But the message has certainly gone out there right throughout this year. What are the needs? Now, obviously, everything has to be evaluated, because we as public servants and the minister will be criticised further down the line if we don't have appropriate governance around everything and appropriate monitoring. But certainly if there's any specific issues, those should be referred to the education authority in the first place.
Well, you'll appreciate the point that Justin's making, that there's a real urgency to making sure that these bids are translated into actual assistance to the pupils that need them.
Yes, and that is part of the ongoing monitoring process of each of these different types of allocations. And it is challenging. It's not to underestimate the challenge for teachers and for the education authority in, you know, evaluating the impact of a lot of this funding within very short timescales, but it is an important factor.
Okay. Yes, Phil, go ahead.
Sorry, I'm just going to, I suppose, reiterate what Gary's saying. To be fair to the EA, there is a demand out there. The devices are coming, but the logistics of getting that number of devices out, of running a procurement, receiving the devices and getting them out is quite challenging. And I know there is a lot of work going on within the EA to make that happen as quickly as possible.
Okay. A very brief supplementary. Are you familiar with, or can you update us on the potential EA procurement of funded access to the Seesaw digital learning platform for primary schools, which would obviously assist remote learning? Something we need to take up with EA potentially?
I would have to come back to you on that. I don't
know. Okay, that's grand. Can I bring in Morris Bradley, MLA? Morris there. Okay. Clark, I don't see Morris on the list of participants there, no? Okay, no problem. Final question for me then. Can I just ask, has the Education Minister bid for funding for a cost of living increase for teachers and the arrears such an uplift would incur?
As we have highlighted that is a potential pressure, but as negotiations are ongoing with the union, for the 2019 and 2020 years. It couldn't have been put in as an inescapable bid, but we have drawn it to the Department of Finance's attention, subject to negotiations with the unions.
Okay, and obviously there's a significant funding gap for next year's budget. Is there a projected overspend for this year's budget?
No.
Okay.
I didn't think I would get to the point of being able to say that, so I say it with some pleasure.
Okay, because there has been for the last number of years.
Yeah, but as I've said, it's mainly because of the extent of additional funding that has gone in this year for COVID and restart related issues.
Okay. Thank you very much for your time this morning. Hopefully you'll see what the priority issues are for the Education Committee there in our questioning. And we look forward to meeting with you again in the near future to keep on top of the budget of the department. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thanks. Okay, can I ask Assembly Broadcasting to remove all of the witnesses from that session and to add all members back into the spotlight and keep them there for now? Can I ask the clerk to summarise actions resulting from that briefing?
Yeah, just unmuting there. Actually, the officials answered really the vast majority of the questions. The two items that I have were about the difference in year pressures compared to previous years. So Gary estimated that it was maybe three times worse in general terms in previous years than this year. When he was explaining how much the COVID money has helped the in-year pressures the past year. Then Daniel had a question about a proposed cut, which the officials weren't cited on. So I'll go back on the recording and gather that up. The Seesaw programme that you asked about, Chairperson, as well, the officials weren't cited on that, so we can put that in the letter from the department. Did anyone have any additional?
Members, any other actions you wish to add? Nope. Okay, members content to agree those actions? Agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Okay, members, that moves us on to agenda item 6 then, our briefing on remote and blended learning from Blend Ed Northern Ireland. Can I ask Assembly Broadcasting to remove all members from the spotlight and to add our witnesses? Can I refer members to a briefing note from the committee clerk at page 27, a briefing paper from Blend Ed Northern Ireland at page 29, and can I welcome Karen Irwin, P2 head teacher of UICT at Ballyclare Primary School, Nicole O'Connor, P3 head teacher of UICT St. Colmkills Primary School and Nursery Unit, Louise Kerr, post-primary teacher, head of history, digital technology leader at St. Joseph's College, Michael O'Kane, principal of St. Colmkills Primary School and Nursery Unit, Pamela Algie, principal Bangor Central Nursery Unit, Alistair Hamill, post-primary teacher, head of geography and senior leadership team at Lurgan College, and John O'Boyle, member of the Goliath Trust. Can I advise witnesses that the committee A is delighted to have you with us today. Remote learning and blended learning is obviously a key issue for children and families across Northern Ireland, teachers, parents, and a real priority issue for our education committee. So we're delighted to have you with us today. Thank you so much for giving up your time to share a bit about the hard work and innovative practice you've been doing in relation to this. We'll give you 10 minutes, and sorry we're so pushed for time today, but we're dealing with a wide range of issues at the moment. So we'll give you 10 minutes to make your opening statement, and followed by questions from the members. Can I ask Assembly Broadcasting to keep the witness in the spotlight and to bring members in when we're asking questions? Okay, can I hand over to our witnesses? Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for having us here this morning. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about our journey and our story so far, and then I'm going to hand over to Nicole for a few minutes after to finish off the rest of our story. So we originally met as a group of Apple Distinguished Educators in 2019. And as a group of only 11 in Northern Ireland, we lead the charge for change in education by speaking with a credible voice. So we can see the power of technology, we can see the power of collaboration and creativity, and it's amazing to pass that on to our pupils. We believe, though, that the world is our classroom, and as a global community of educators, as ADEs, we can learn and share from the experiences of others. And this was never more evident than during the start of this pandemic. ADEs across the globe led the way in this, how we've got to the point where we're at today. So we listened to them, we watched their experiences, we heard their schools closing, we heard about them going online, and we asked questions, we followed their example, and when it came and hit our country, we were as ready as we could be. So in May 2020, I was sitting one Saturday morning and just dropped a little text to the guys, as we do. It's just a quick message, and everything goes from there. And I just said, do you think there's something we can do here? We have the ability, we have the enthusiasm for it. Could we help out a few teachers in Northern Ireland with getting to grips with technology? At that stage, people were under a lot of pressure. It was right in the middle of remote learning. So we called ourselves Blend Ed because at that stage, we were talking about the possibility of going back to a blended learning environment where children would be learning in school and learning from home. As it was, we went straight back to the classroom, but that was fine because we were still able to speak into that situation and offer advice. So our strapline in all of this has been teachers supporting teachers, and that's what we're about. We are teachers ourselves, and we just want to get alongside other teachers, help them with the technology, help them with the ideas, and support them as we go along. We do lots of training sessions online, and if you've ever attended one, you won't get by the starting few minutes without hearing about start with why. We always say start with why, and we will bring up the points of why we're doing what we're doing. We believe that using technology should be purposeful, it should engage and inspire children. So for example, on Monday night when we did a session about augmented reality, that could be a gimmick, that could be used for a bit of fun, but actually it has real purpose. And when you look at the purpose behind using technology to allow for creativity, learning through experience, creating space for visual and engaging learners, it's amazing. So our aim back in May was that we'd support maybe 20 teachers, and they'd come along and we'd help them out with a few questions. And within hours of bringing our idea, we organised our first conversation and 700 people signed up, and we were quite honestly blown away. We weren't expecting it. That conversation spiralled into more conversations where we were able to pull in ADEs from around the world who had already returned to work after their first pandemic. Their schools had opened again, and we were able to bring them in for advice and ideas. Then in the summer, we organised Amplify, which was an online training event for 2 days. And we did 28 sessions over those 2 days from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m., which in hindsight was a lot, but it was really well responded to. We had over 3,000 attendees came along to those sessions. We covered things from reading in a digital era, outdoor learning, pastoral care, virtual learning environments, creating movies. And the best thing at the end of it was the responses that we had back from teachers. Things such as, I was really nervous to go back to school in September, but now I'm actually really inspired and excited. So we've been doing regular training sessions as the year has gone on. And what we love most is that we're really reactive, and that's probably the word we use most to describe ourselves. We react really quickly to the situations around us. If we discover something that works better, we're straight in. We're sharing those ideas with everybody. If we get questions from people that about how to use their remote learning platforms or technology, we are straight back in with an answer. And we usually drop a text, and 30 minutes later, the session is arranged, and 30 minutes later, it's fully booked. We only have space on our platform and Teams through CPK to hold 300 participants, and within 30 minutes, those are full. So we're ending up repeating popular sessions again for anyone who still wanted to come. We hopefully are accessible, down to earth, and approachable, and we hope that that's why people are coming along to listen to us. We're also really happy to say, during the last lockdown, we tried this, it was a disaster, don't do it, do this instead. We've learned from this, we've gained more experience, we've learned, we've explored, try this instead. But we always reinforce, and we say it all through our sessions, this is not the way to do this, this is our way, and it might help you. Use it if it suits you, use it if it doesn't. Take what you've said and see if you can use it in your own way. But none of us have ever taught in a pandemic before. None of us have ever taught our class from an iPad on the kitchen table before. This is new to everyone. everyone, every teacher in the world is learning how to do this, and we hope that we can be shining a light and inspiration into this situation. So I'm going to hand over to Nicole for a few minutes.
Absolutely, Karen. It sounds great when you put it that way, our journey to date. And I'm going to pick up again on the word reactive. Whilst we have been reactive to the needs of our profession, we do know that as full-time educators, it's simply not possible for us to support everyone in the ways they want and that they need. So many teachers have told us that they keep coming back to us for that reason of authenticity and tried and tested strategies that stem from classroom-based practice. Like this month alone, we have trained over 1,000 teachers in areas such as Seesaw, preschool, and augmented reality, as Karen mentioned there. And since we started, that has amassed to over 6,500 teachers attending our sessions, simply for that reason that they relate to our content as fellow educators. They have that pedagogical perspective rather than solely having that technical how-to perspective. We're also incredibly conscious that teachers are attending our sessions after long and intense days of remote teaching, whilst also supporting home learning for their own families and living through a pandemic like us all. So they want quick, concise training that's easily accessible and relevant. So we seek to give teachers straightforward takeaway ideas and resources that they can use in their classrooms the very next day. In fact, we would consider ourselves failing if we hadn't done that, but we do it, and they come back to us and they share their successes, which keeps us going, and it helps us go and provide more. But as a team of educators, ultimately, we're not actually accountable to anybody above us or caught up in any bureaucracy. We have no hidden agendas. In fact, we're incredibly open about our agenda, which is that we want to create a culture of sharing amongst teachers in Northern Ireland. The main reason we're able to do this at the moment, I think, is because we have that creative license and freedom to shape our content and provision in the way that works for us. And it also works for our audience, you know, because at the moment, they are engaging with us passionately and positively. But we find ourselves thinking, wouldn't it be great if that same flexibility and agency was given to schools to respond to the resourcing and training needs of their staff and pupil body? At the moment, Chair, some of our schools and members of our profession are drowning, whilst others are sailing through remote learning. And that's because we're not all in the same boat. We're just in the same storm. And from our lens, this crisis has hit our schools with immense force. And whilst most of us given witness here today are actually incredibly fortunate to be in schools that have been forward-thinking and often ahead of the curve with digital technology, we are well aware that there are many schools that do not have the same ICT resources and skills that we are fortunate to have. And indeed, the entire nursery sector is without any funded ICT support and infrastructure. So this makes us reflect inwardly and question, goodness, if we are finding remote learning to be a struggle and at times overwhelming, then how must our fellow colleagues feel who are not in our positions in terms of resourcing and skill set? Yes, we would love to see a device loaned out to every learner in Northern Ireland equipped with age-appropriate learning tools. And of course, this needs to be supported with the appropriate Wi-Fi provision to make this meaningful. But wouldn't it be powerful to see schools given the autonomy to choose the devices that they need to match the skill set of their staff and to complement the existing resources in the school? Whilst I know from my own school we would gratefully receive any support and resources, but we probably would have a preference if we were given the choice to build upon the investment that we have already put into our staff development and, you know, just to help us instead of having to get to grips with different systems and modes of delivery. But actually for us as Blended, and I know our colleagues from Goliath would believe that actually the teacher's device is probably the least important part of the remote learning equation. The most important part to making remote learning or blended learning, if we go to that scenario, a success, is teaching the teacher behind the device. You could have all the latest equipment and gadgets in the world, but if you don't know how to teach and engage learners online, then the tech is totally useless. Pedagogy needs to come first, and whilst it may look and feel different online, the principles are the same as those in the classroom. Pupils need to see, hear, and learn from their teachers. They need opportunities to apply their learning, and they need to receive feedback to help develop their skills. So that has always been our message to attendees. Teaching is teaching. It doesn't matter if the school down the road is using iPads and you're using Chromebooks, or the school up the road is using Google Classroom and you're using Seesaw. Anyone can source tutorials on how to functionally operate those tools and devices, but what teachers need to know is how to pedagogically and purposefully use these tools for remote learning. But we also need to ensure that these newly learned skills are transferable and carried forward when we all return to full-time classroom teaching, because it would be such a shame to waste all the upskilling that we've done. it would be great to have this sort of encompassed into a digital strategy for education in Northern Ireland, where statutory bodies and providers of teacher professional learning delivered content in collaborative partnership with practicing educators rather than solely at the profession, you know, just to ensure that the training has that relevant curricular and classroom-based focus. Traditionally, sharing within Northern Ireland has maybe been quite insular. Like, it usually takes place within individual schools or clusters of schools. But that has been changing over the last number of years. And we know from our first-hand experience that the pandemic has acted as a catalyst for teachers to share, support and encourage each other. So we'd love to see a well-designed, structured digital portal that provides teachers with access to everything they need, including but like sort of not limited to things like upcoming training, curricular exemplars, helpful resources, because quite frankly, Chair, at the moment, teachers are inundated. We're overwhelmed with the amount of great content and opportunities to upskill, but it's coming from multiple bodies within Northern Ireland, and it's hard to keep up, even as ourselves, we have our ears quite close to the ground. But we believe that this could all be centralised into one location where everyone who wants to contribute could share their offering, whether they're a funded educational body or a practicing teacher. Now, this type of like sort of systemic collaboration could have huge impacts on sustainable upskilling and resourcing of the teaching profession. It actually gets us really excited because ultimately it would have the greatest impact on the children and young people that we all serve. Now, we know this is ambitious. It could require a lot of joined up thinking and a culture shift within the education system, because there's many reasons why this type of mass sharing isn't already happening, from people wanting recognition for their own work and those who are maybe insecure about sharing their work, or those who simply don't have the platform to do so. But I think all of us on this call today would agree that if we've learned anything from this pandemic, it's that we can't do this alone. We need support from each other to help achieve our common goal of providing our learners with access to their education in this digital era. And no matter what we discuss on this call today and going forward, we must keep our children and young people at the heart of everything we do. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you so much, Karen and Nicole. I think this is one of the most important evidence sessions this committee is going to take this term. And I'm really, really grateful that you accepted my invitation to come and meet with us today. You're a credit to your profession, your schools, and to the children and young people that you serve. I've attended quietly some of the sessions that you've carried out in recent months, and I've just been so inspired by the can-do attitude, the dedication, and the innovation that you've been involved in. Can I ask what has been the extent of support that you have received, that teachers have received from statutory bodies in relation to digital learning, pedagogy, hardware and software?
Yeah, thank you. I think that is probably one of the most important questions that we'd want to discuss, and I'll maybe pass that one over to Pamela to start us off, because I know you've had discussions with your link officer, for example, and then maybe Michael could join in.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Nicole. So I am the principal of a nursery school, so our experience has been slightly different because we sit outside of C2K. In terms of support from EA, ETI, statutory bodies, The biggest thing for me has been our link officer. Our cross-organisational link officer is provided to every school, and she's great for advice if we need something. Case studies have been useful, seeing what practice is happening in other places. So there have been things, but probably the most useful thing is speaking to other educators, speaking to other teachers, finding out what they're doing, how things are going for them, and then creating your own response. For nursery, in terms of hardware and software and support that way, really it's very limited. I know that colleagues across Northern Ireland have found it very challenging because we don't have the devices. My teachers don't have the C2K teacher laptops because we sit outside of C2K. So it is an additional challenge for my phase of education. But there is support there, and a lot of onus is on principals to go out and have a wee look and see what they can find and draw support from colleagues as well.
Yeah. Michael, as a principle you can maybe take up for primary schools, how we are supported?
Yes, Nicole. Thanks very much for passing it over. Very much echoing what Pamela has just said, our ETI District Inspector, Julie Harris, has been first class. I would say, personally, the ETI have really came to the fore over the last 6 months in terms of a public body, in terms of support for schools. And, you know, she has been contacting our school very regularly to offer her support, but also for answering any questions that we might have. Our link officers as well, Marie McCann, is on hand. But also, I found our local principal cluster group, which feeds into this area, has been excellent, with lots of different, you know, ideas and strategies for what might happen going forward. And just a sort of an associate to this group, Blend Ed and A themselves, the ladies there and then Alistair, have been absolutely fantastic. And, you know, I do have the opportunity to speak to quite a lot of schools in my role, and they keep referencing the great support from Blend Ed and A. But in terms of those public statutory bodies, you know, I'm, you know, very, very happy with the support from the ETI over the last sort of 6 months, 8 months.
Okay, thank you for that. And are there, in terms of the C2K network then, are there key issues of feedback in terms of the fit for purposeness of the C2K network? Are there particular platforms that you found to work best that the Education Authority, the Department of Education, should prioritise investment in?
Karen, I maybe direct that one to you as a fellow ICT coordinator.
Sure. There's a lot of great support within C2K for post-primary schools with and older primary age children as well, with Google Classroom and Teams. As a primary teacher, I teach P2. I couldn't use that technology with my pupils, so I have been using Seesaw, which is widely used across the country, and it is a fantastic tool. We haven't got long enough for me to talk about how amazing Seesaw is. On our team, three of us are Seesaw certified educators, and between us, we've almost 19 years of combined experience of using Seesaw. It is not, unfortunately, at the current time supported, so we have paid for that ourselves. So we started on the free version 7 years ago, and then when lockdown came, it made sense to keep going. So there was no new technology for our pupils to learn. They had been using it all along. But during the first lockdown, I had access to the fuller version of it. And there are so many more benefits to the full version that we couldn't look past purchasing it for our school. It's a massive budget allowance to pay for it out of a cost of a school per pupil in the school. But the background data, the admin side of it is incredible. We are able to track engagement of all our families. We can engage with our vulnerable families through it and make sure that they are engaging, or if they're not, we can contact them. We are able to see how much uptake of learning has been taken, all as admin. This is before you even go into the classroom as the teacher. We have skills observation grids where we're able to keep all our observations and records of pupil ability. We can communicate with our parents on a whole school basis and send out information. We can download spreadsheets of engagement to focus on families that haven't engaged, and we can target support. We also add in our learning support assistants into each classroom so that they are able to work alongside their one-to-one pupils, even remotely. And it is completely child-friendly. I am speaking, though, from experience of the full version, and I know that that is not supported. So I'm going to hand over to John, who is from Goliath Hub, and he's going to talk about his experience of using it as well.
So very briefly, John, just before you do, I realise I'm well over my time here, folks, but hopefully my colleagues will give me a bit of latitude, given I'm not using this time you guys are, which I think is really important. And potentially, John, maybe you could make some reference. It's my understanding that the Education Authority is currently considering the procurement of access to the funded version of Seesaw for primary schools, and maybe you could make some mention as to just how important an investment that might be. Thank you for your indulgence, colleagues, but I think this is important to hear from John on this matter. Thank you, John.
Yeah, so thank you very much for having us on, and thank you very much as well to Blended NI to share your time, as it were. Yes, we are in awe of Blended NI and the massive work that they've been doing, amount of work, and the expertise there is phenomenal. As literally as Nicole was saying there, around the device availability and the skill set of the teacher, Given where we are, our trust represents schools, 24 schools in socially deprived areas, so we wouldn't have that digital technology. And one of our, the main emphasis of us is to deal with digital inequality and boost digital literacy, even at a more fundamental level. We would love to aspire to have all the different skills and equipment that my colleagues here in Blended and I have. However, we feel that it's something that would give like party provision for our children if it was to go ahead. And we're very grateful to particularly Brian Steen, Dale Heaney, and Damien Harvey as well from EA and C2K. They have been working behind the scenes. It's been very slow and moving. We first met with Brian on the 27th of February last year as head of educational IT to try and get that push over the line, and we're still now at this stage going for it. Now, it is our understanding that funding for the rest of this year has been released through the Education Restart Programme. We've been told that since the 14th of September that had been agreed. We are now calling for two things. The first thing that we are asking for is in the interim, this is pushed through for the rest of this year. So anecdotally, we have done a scoping exercise and of teachers who've responded to our request asking about what platforms they're using. Combined, 79% of primary schools that have responded to us specifically are using CSTOP. And of that, for almost half, 48% of those who are using CSTOP are using the free version, which is extremely limited in its provision. I've had a lot of colleagues contact other schools and within our trust, very upset, have people lean on them around, why are we not getting the other version? Why is it not coming over the line? They're actually having to delete. So we're talking there about, teacher workload and burnout. Teachers are actually having to delete stuff that they maybe have on from last term that is excellent educational material, but they cannot read, but they have had to delete that off their account because they're limited to the number of activities they have. Platform. I don't want to get into it too much, obviously, but it's a great platform.
Yeah, John, and I think some of my colleagues will probably ask questions that allow you to respond in a wee bit more detail as well. But probably best for me just to pause you just there for now and bring some of those colleagues in. Can I? Thanks so much so far, folks. Can I bring in Karen Mullen, MLA, Deputy Chair?
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, everybody, for joining us this morning. I also agree with the Chair. This is probably one of the most important sessions that we have had, and I wanted to credit you all. I also attended one of your sessions, early sessions, and was really inspired, like the Chair, took back about how many, the high numbers that he's had there and how engaging it was. It was absolutely excellent, and you could see the support there. So I want to commend you on that. You have answered a lot of my questions in the briefing there. I fully agree in relation to the digital strategy, and just listening to these, it just reinforces that and the disparity that is across the system. So I suppose the last bit, and I know John touched on it there, was what I was going to ask, but what should be the next steps for the department to move quickly to equip and support our teachers in using these tools?
John, do you want to come back in? Yeah. Yep. Thanks.
So our call is twofold at this stage. We believe that it's now with the Chief Executive of the EA, Sarah Long, and she has it. Obviously, I couldn't even imagine what her entry is like at the moment. God bless her. But our first call is in the immediacy, we need this funding released now for the rest of this academic year. That funding has already been earmarked and released from the Education Restart Programme. And given the purpose of that programme, it's apparent that it's done yesterday, last week. Where people are at their wits' end, teachers are burning out, and children are being disadvantaged. So that's the first call.
Second, John, just when you say funding, what specific funding do you mean there? Sorry, yeah.
We have Damien Harvey from C2K has costed out funding for providing all primary, nursery, and special schools for 50%, 75%, and 100% of licences, because not all schools are using them. And as Pamela alluded to earlier, nursery are not within the C2K network. So even within that, they wouldn't have the two nurseries that replied are using Class Dojo as an alternative.
And John, just to clarify, this is funding for the funded version of Seesaw. Is that what you mean? Yeah.
For schools, it would be like jumping from a clapped out ladder from the 80s to a Ferrari, top of the range Ferrari. and that's what we want to release immediately. It's a real matter of urgency, and we cannot push that quick enough. And the second thing is, and I believe this is what the delay is that they're looking for maybe a 3 to 5 year plan to continue that provision, because as my colleagues and then and I have alluded to, yes, there is provision through C2K for Teams, MS Teams and Google Classroom, but they are not fit for purpose for primary school aged children, for special school and for nursery. Whereas this would be a platform that would cover all Northern Ireland schools at that end. I believe Glenda and I think it's Louise, has a great example from St Justice and Kilkenny, where they actually use in first year as a transition material or a transitional portal. So they have that impact on primary schools, so they're feeder schools. That, as a former secondary teacher, I couldn't imagine how great that information would be to have that. It would help that transition process something fierce. So we would like to see that would be first years would be able to do that, because we're seeing at the moment there is misinformation. I think a lot of key stage two schools where they're using Google Classrooms or Teams whilst down the school is seesaw. And in terms of track engagement, that's not really helpful. Likewise, in our school, we do that just because of the scheduling and to give them the transferable skills from Google Classroom in the primary setting up to secondary. I would argue that if they can navigate to seesaw, that virtual learning environment, those skills are completely transferable, whether they go to a post-primary that uses Teams or their own or anything else, that this is more fit for purpose and it needs to be.
Thanks for that, John. Bring Karen back in there. Thank you,
John. I suppose you have just reinforced for myself and I'm sure all our committee members that it is vital that we get seesaw into all our primaries, nurseries and special schools. And I'll just finish with, and listening to you, John, just brought me back to Nicole's comment earlier. And I'm going to steal it and use it again, Nicole, to describe our current situation that around the education and the inequalities that's there in terms of particularly the digital side at the minute, not all in the same boat, but we're all in the same storm. So we need to do better to immediately provide our schools. It's nearly a year under this pandemic. Blended and remote, blended learning is the future as well, regardless if you're in the classroom, and we need to ensure that that's in place. Thank you, Saul. It's been great. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Karen. Can I bring in William Humphrey, MLA?
Okay, thanks very much, Chairman. Can I thank you both very much, Karen and Nicole, for your presentation. It was inspiring, I have to say. This initiative is tremendous, and the passion and the drive that you bring to it is hugely encouraging. So thank you very much, and thank you all very much for what you do for our young people and the important role that you carry out in our schools. Can I just ask, in terms of shortfalls, we obviously are aware that the access to technology has been a difficulty, and I've raised this consistently on behalf of my constituents. What were the other shortfalls, do you think, in terms of your initiative, in terms of spreading it across Northern Ireland?
Thank you for that question. I might pass it over to Alistair to talk about that for me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thanks to the committee for the opportunity to come and speak and to share here. Shortfalls is there certainly are challenges here, but I think one of the important things that we need to be doing here is to be taking a look at how we turn into the wave. This has been the phrase I've been using with our staff all the way through this time as we've been getting ready for it. We know that there are challenges coming. So how do we try and anticipate those, and how do we turn into the wave? So some of the challenges that we're looking at, that we're trying to meet here, there is absolutely the challenge of the technology. And that's I would put it like this, it's a necessary condition. If we do not have system-wide access to fit-for-purpose technology and software, and if our children and young people don't have access to that and the Wi-Fi connectivity, then everything else, no matter how good it is, won't happen. But having that alone is merely the foundation. So one of the challenges then is, how do we use this well? How do we make sure that teachers are enabled not just simply to deliver content through digital formats like this, but how do we enable them to interact? And as Nicole, I think, said earlier on, what we do in the classroom is exactly what we're trying to do here, but the context is different. and we have to learn new ways of doing it. And one of the exciting things to meet that challenge is all across the system, there's been bubbling up of all these great innovative ideas. And I think it's one of the reasons why Blended NI has worked so well, because it's tapped into that exact thing that's happening. Teachers are coming up with incredible solutions. Not all, but there's some amazing things happening. And then our conference during the summer was to amplify that. So we're speaking into the situation of, yes, how do you use the technology? Yes, 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 that's important. But how do you use it for a learning outcome? That's the key. So one of the things then moving forward in terms of that challenge then is how we as a system come together to support that. Now, I know the EA portal has been collating together a whole bunch of case studies from teachers and schools across Northern Ireland to share out. And I think that's one of the most important things that we can do moving forward, how we capture these innovative practices going on so that then we can share them. At the moment, a lot of the sharing of good practice, again, Nicole alluded to this earlier on, tends to be siloed, or has tended to be siloed. There are some exciting things happening in certain geographical locations. So if you look down at the Newry Shared Education Hub, for instance, the joint professional development that's happening there really is very innovative. But in some ways, we have been a little bit of prisoners of postcode in education at the moment. If you happen to be in a school where exciting things are happening, or in an area learning community where exciting things are happening, you can access it. But a lot of teachers aren't. But here we are, embracing technology to break down. I'm a geography teacher, so it pains me to say this, almost to overcome the barriers of geography, to use that phrase, especially when the history teacher here listening in. But to overcome the barriers of geography just like this, where actually it doesn't matter which school you're in Northern Ireland, it doesn't matter which area learning community you're in, wherever there is good practice, we can access it. So it's about the system looking at that and finding ways of really connecting those opportunities for us to share.
Okay, thanks, Alistair. William?
Yeah, thanks for that, Alistair. Nicole, you talked about getting all of our young people in the same boat. And I suppose, I think Michael's point about the clusters and the sharing of information and leadership is obviously crucial in all this. What suggestions have you got to make sure they are all in the same boat? You know, you be our Noah this morning.
Well, Noah has a team and is supported in a collaborative effort with this. So I'm going to invite Louise to come on to talk about that, because her school is one with one-to-one iPads. So I think she might be best placed to talk about this one.
Thanks, Nicole. Probably where I'm going to start with that question is to say that we are at an advantage because we had a very forward-thinking principal quite a number of years ago. So devices are not a major issue for us. So we're concentrating on the skills that we're bringing to our children. And as Alistair sort of alluded to too, we're bringing across bring the skills for students and future-proof them, not just with teachers, because we're all here to collaborate and to share our ideas, but we want to make sure children all attain the same skills. So SIA have created their digital hub and talked about digital workers, digital makers and digital citizens way back from 2015, when it was decided that we need to future-proof our young people. So we're bringing those skills into the classroom even pre-pandemic, and I'm very conscious that post-pandemic those skills will remain. We want our citizens to have good online safety, access to emails, be able to online bank, right through to digital makers who'll eventually make the technology that we'll all be talking about, the Ferraris, John, in the future, to move through things. So I think bringing those skills together is very, very important. But I suppose first you need to upskill your teachers.
Chair, can I just finish with this? I think final point, it's not a question, I just want to make this point. I think that those new skills you talk about post-COVID are hugely important. And I think the thing around that, Louise, is I suppose we need to make sure that when it comes to teacher training in the future, that these skills are part of that teacher training. So that's there. And it's, I'm really encouraged that you've been able to train over 1,000 teachers. But I think this should be part of the teacher training curriculum. Thanks, Chair.
Thanks, William.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Chris, could I just add on to the end of that point that William made? You know, we have been approached by the initial teacher education colleges to deliver training for their students so that like they have seen our platform and they've recognized that they want to bring that in. Obviously, it's, I mentioned at the start, it's not really sustainable for us to do this whilst full-time teachers, but that should encompass, that should come into a digital strategy for Northern Ireland. The teachers, the student teachers coming into classrooms should be equipped with the skills to deal with remote learning or blended learning, whatever scenario we have.
Thanks, Nicole. Can I bring in Daniel McCrossan?
Yeah, thank you, Chair, and thank you to all our guests for their presentation and for their insight into some of the great work they're doing, and also to highlight some of the challenges that exist. We're in no easy time and very worrying for a lot of people. I know that many parents are struggling as well at home with having to adapt, and also teachers and schools as well. So there's many issues, and I'm glad to see John O'Boyle. John, we had spoken earlier in the week in relation to Seesaw, very exciting plans that you have in relation to it. I'm just going to go straight to questions because the chair is very strict today on the timing, and I tend to babble. So
you'll thank me for it later. Go ahead.
What is your assessment of the success of remote and blended learning during the pandemic? In particular, I would like to hear about the things you found most helpful and why. I would also like to like you to tell me about the things that hindered you and why they were a hindrance. And finally, what recommendations you'd make for future pandemic planning, given that we're nearly a year into this. Thank you.
Thank you. Karen, could I ask you to start on that one? Thank you.
Yeah, I think the point you make about parents should not be underestimated. I have three boys all in primary school, juggling that at home as well. So I totally have solidarity with the parents who are doing this. And to that mind, that is how we upskilled from last lockdown to this one, is that we provided much more teaching for our pupils, that it wasn't a case last time. Let's be honest, it was an emergency situation and we did what we could and we adapted as time went on. This time we were planned and we were ready. And I feel like everybody spent the time that was given between the last lockdown and this one to upskill themselves. That jump has been greater for some schools than for others, but everybody has jumped and everybody has improved, which is fantastic. And people come along and they listen to us. Like in January alone, 1,000 teachers over the course of, since we started, 6,000 teachers. And they're all taking on board what we're saying and they're doing it and they're stepping up every time. But we have never had any lift and go lessons for this. This is done on a daily basis, and this is hours and hours of work behind the scenes that doesn't get seen. So teachers are planning late into the evenings, they're planning at weekends, they're creating, they're coming to our sessions. We do all of this outside of our work hours because this is not our job. We have our teaching job and we voluntarily do this afterwards. So we are doing evening sessions, 8 p.m. teachers are turning up. Let me know what I can do. What can I do? Like, I have never been more proud of teachers in this country. They are genuinely incredible. So the positives that have come out of this have been an incredible amount of collaboration among teachers. You probably don't always see that. It's the little messages in the background. It's the turning up at the 8 p.m. sessions and just sitting quietly on their camera and listening. It's the sending us a little message going, I'm just really not sure. Like, what do I do next? It's all that behind the scenes. It's just incredible. And the collaboration that has come out of this cannot be underestimated. Another positive that has come out of this is
just briefly, at given time, I know you guys will always err on the positives, but take this as an opportunity that Daniel has given you this to reflect genuinely if there are barriers or if there are, you know, areas where you needed more support. Yeah.
Be bluntly honest. We're the nice guys.
See, we're too used to being the nice guys. Does anyone else want to jump in with negatives?
If you're talking about the jump that you made, Karen, from the last one to this one, we have been, as I said there, got support in principle from Brian Steen on the 27th of February last year. We're now nearly a year later that the bureaucracy and red tape has left us. We have not got Seesaw for Schools at this stage. Seesaw for Schools, well, I completely endorse everything Karen's saying around the positives around collaboration and sharing of ideas and resources, and that's been echoed as well with Nicole. This Seesaw, if we got it as a Northern Ireland-wide thing, we could have a district library of materials and things that are on for a shared curriculum of superb resources. Nicole mentioned talking about having that portal to be able to do that. Well, if we had that and the teacher's only as good as the teacher behind the device, well, actually, then all of our children, and our children, I'm talking about Gaia children, are some of our most socially deprived within Belfast, and certainly, I would argue, within Northern Ireland. And actually, not only would they have that expertise within our schools, but actually, some of these guys, some of them are teaching in P5 and have a fantastic resource, I can dip into that as a district library. So it's working smarter, not harder. It's given us the chance to be able to do that. It's given us the chance to either do really, really excellent asynchronous lessons and actually do that, give the verbal feedback. I take my hat off 100% to any teacher who is teaching their own children as remote learners as well as doing this. I do not know. I have no idea how to do it. I literally had yesterday a colleague from another school who's an ICT coordinator who felt she felt lambasted. Not really, but that's how she felt at that stage. She was at her wits' end, four children of her own, trying to teach them, do remote learning, doing supervised learning, and trying to deliver her own online teaching. And it was the frustrations that were coming through because we don't have these tools. And like, it's great, okay, all the bodies that have got us so far, but I think it's ridiculous that we're not over the line yet and we're still waiting. When's this going to come? So I've heard whimpers between 3 weeks up to 6 weeks to get CSOL for Skills switched on for Northern Ireland. That's just not good enough.
Okay. Daniel,
yous are far too nice for your own good. I really wanted yous to tell me what yous need in order to support yous in achieving what yous are trying to achieve. And like, it's so important, particularly in this pandemic, given that there's so many issues, that yous are very direct with what yous need and what yous require, because this is a golden opportunity. Yous are on a public record now. People need to know this. And I think the chair, thank you for coming in, chair. I think you need to get straight to the point and say, here's what we need. Here's what the issues are. Please make this happen. Help us get this sorted out. And Karen, you're 100% right about teachers. Teachers have been the forgotten heroes in this pandemic, the people that have really stepped up the mark to provide vital support for so many families out there and are going way beyond the call of duty, and also have huge stresses in their own home as well, and trying to work from home, teach their own children, and also provide necessary support and education to others. And the final question, Chair, and I know you'll indulge me, could I direct a question to Pamela Algy, Principal Bangor Central Nursery? What place do you see for ICT in a nursery setting? And have you been well served by ICT provision from the EA? And again, do not be afraid to be very, very direct.
Okay, thanks, Daniel, Pamela, and then I'm coming to Robbie straight away. Thanks, okay. Pamela.
I think there is a place for ICT use in nursery, certainly for communicating with parents, supporting parents. We're using CSAW and we're doing videos and sending them to the children. The children are sending us photos of what they're doing at home. But obviously preschool children learn through play. So it's a blended approach. Some of our children are learning through playing with Play-Doh or playing with chalk outside. So it's a blended and balanced approach, the same as it is at any stage of education. I think for nursery skills, certainly there has been extra provision made. I mean, I received a desktop computer from the Education Authority last week, and that means we now have two in the school. But I think nursery skills would welcome additional provision and training. But I think that's the same for any school at the minute. I would welcome additional training and resourcing.
Okay. Thank you, Pamela. Thanks, Daniel. Robbie Butler, MLA.
Thank you.
Robbie there, okay.
Yeah, Chair.
Thanks, Robbie.
It takes about 10 seconds for me to come in here and then press the button.
Guys, no problem.
As Daniel has said, can't say this enough, each and every one of you is our heroes, okay? So I'm going to say some good stuff. I'm going to do the sandwich. I'm going to give you some good stuff. I'm going to give you some reality, and then we'll finish on the good stuff, okay, if that's okay? So first minute is the good stuff. So I have recognised and I've seen a lot of stuff shared on social media of an extremely good practice. I'm going to name a couple of names here, and it's only two names. There's more names, but Alistair, you've been outstanding in terms of sharing your examples on there. So your credit to what you do. There's also another guy, Kevin, who's the principal at St. Ronan's, again, in primary school provision, Kevin's outstanding. He uses a platform called Dojo, I believe. I mean, and I know there's many other people there, Karen and Brandon, I do see stuff. Those two guys just are quite, when they tackle politicians, they don't hold back. So the stuff that they say is very, very good. Okay. There's no doubt there's a lot of children have been very well served. However, there is an inequality at the moment, and it is not your fault, okay? You guys are at the cutting edge of the innovation and tackling the problem, but there's a huge disparity across Northern Ireland with regard to what pupils are getting. Now, there are a number of reasons for that, I believe, and you can contradict me. Some of it is the digital poverty. Some of it is that pedagogy that's talked about, so some teachers and some pupils may not be best fit. At the moment, there's another one which I don't know the answer to, but is there a resistance, it was maybe touched on a little bit earlier, but is there resistance by some teachers to embrace this and teaching unions, more importantly? And the reason I'm saying that, teaching unions have been very good at working. They were working with me on the AQE stuff, even though it caused some pain and stuff. But what I've recognised across the education sector is the disconnect. The disconnect between nursery and primary, between primary and post-primary, and between post-primary and higher education. What you guys are doing and giving me heart is representatives from all here. You seem to be all knitting together. Can you give confidence that this is cradle-to-grave type stuff? So from nursery right through to post-primary, that this talks to each other and it doesn't further fragment and segment our education system, because it's woeful at the moment.
Absolutely, and I think when you look at what our team is made up of, you know, whilst we did start off as for myself, Karen and Louise and Michael, we added to our team to include Pamela because we knew we needed that nursery representation. And Alistair, again, providing more insight for A-level and for post-primary. So it is from cradle to grave, as you said there, Robbie. I might ask Michael to come in here, because I know Michael has just gone from teaching full-time to now being a principal full-time, and he might have an insight there as well.
Thanks, Nicole. I wouldn't be talking too negatively about teachers, to be honest, and a disconnect for teachers in terms of maybe a reluctance, Robbie. I think I wouldn't say you've got your information wrong there. I would just tell you what I'm seeing. You know, through blended NNA, I work with so many schools, and I have to say, and I'll say this very passionately, the amount of principals and ICT leaders who have commented to me how they're more less confident teachers at using technology prior to this have excelled. I think Pamela could add as well, she has got a sort of less confident member of staff in her nursery, and how that member of staff has really developed the confidence at using technology to serve the needs of the children. So I think if you speak to the majority of principals across the country, they'll agree with that. In terms of a disconnect, I think sometimes, and it's not a negative, but there are a lot of sort of groups and public bodies and even groups like ourselves in this part of the country in the north. And we all have the same goal and aim. But if we could maybe cut out the disconnect and work on the connect in terms of a strategic regional approach to learning and teaching with technology, nobody has got any agendas, definitely not that. But everybody does want the same thing. But there's that many different ways of going about it. And we only have, you know, over a million people in this part of the island as such. So that's possibly a big part of the digital strategy going ahead. You know, but I have to say, not so much a disconnect and people going in their own direction, more to develop that sense of working together. And I suppose with lots of other areas of the sort of the country in the pandemic, it's a good chance to just draw a line and come up. And I have to say, SEA have worked very well with that. There's one of the SEA officers put together a sort of primary advisory group, and they've asked lots of people out of this group, but also from across different areas, nursery, primary, C2K, EA, to sort of develop a strategy for the way forward. So the way is bright, you know, and that's supported by ETA as well, with their sort of you know, the resources since the pandemic began. But I will also say personally, on a personal note, speaking to other teachers, getting advice from other teachers like Karen and Nicole and Louise and Alistair and Pamela, that has been fantastic. And I do have to say on one last point, the teachers in my own school, they blow me away every day with what they're doing and the passionate sort of about tech and the technology. So that really does, you know, show the way forward for me, to be honest.
Thanks, Michael. Robbie?
Brilliant, Michael. Thank you. That last minute or two, and I know I'm nearly out of time, but thank you very much for that, Michael. That gives me some confidence. I'm going to give the last word to Alistair here, if that's okay. Alistair, would you like to set out for the committee what the vision is for pupils, if we can do that, as Karen said, that creative degree of style of learning and using this methodology, please?
Alistair, I think you might be on mute. If you want to unmute there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Robbie, thanks for asking that question. And I think it's great to ask the from the point of view of the pupils what their experience is. I'm sorry, committee, you've got a bunch of optimists here, so you're just going to have to cope with the fact that we look at the bright side of things. I think there's more opportunities here moving forward. What I have found, certainly within our school, and again, Nicole mentioned in the same storm, but not necessarily the same boat, the analogy that I used for this is, and I've been using this all the way through, that a rising tide lifts all boats, which means that we have the opportunity through this to upskill not just teachers, but pupils in the education system across Northern Ireland. But the rising tide that is hitting us over and over again is much more like a tsunami. Now, again, I have to get a little bit of a geography lesson in here, isn't it? But there is such a thing as tsunami preparedness. Some countries are better able to forecast and respond to tsunamis than others. And there's some schools that were just a little bit further down the road whenever the tsunami hit. Ours was, I like to think, one of them, in that we'd been using Google Classroom for a number of years and having a very open bring your own device policy to allow the students to bring their digital devices into school so that they can be using them in the classroom, which meant that the staff and the pupils were at least familiar with using these things moving into this. Now, what I think the opportunity moving forward is this. I'm actually finding, although teaching from home is difficult and frustrating and has its challenges, and I really, really miss the classroom, I am finding that there are ways that I can interact with the students using technology that I wasn't able to.
Sorry to interrupt you. Can I just check the other other attendees mute their devices just to mute what sounds like a very healthy dog in the background?
It's his dog.
Yeah.
The dog reports as being quiet the entire time. It's my dog. Yeah, it's quiet the entire time until my mic's muted.
Go ahead and orchestra with your dog there.
Yeah, no, this is one of the joys.
He's cheering you on there. Go ahead.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, so I was just talking about how I'm actually able to use these technological devices. And because my students are sitting with devices at home and the greater access to devices at home than they would in school. So, Daniel, you asked earlier on, you know, are there blockages? Are there things that we could have? Yeah, I mean, I mentioned earlier, it's not about the technology, but yeah, we'll always take more devices. You know, the more that we can move towards a one-to-one within schools, the better. But what I'm seeing through all of this, and it was very exciting to notice this in the first instance, is how through this learning from home, many of our students are increasingly getting an agency over their own learning. They're getting to the point where, and I think especially in post-primary, whenever you're getting to the GCSE and A level, these are students that are having to take a lot more ownership and responsibility for managing both synchronous and asynchronous delivery. And what I'm seeing now with some of these some of these pupils that I'm teaching is that they are now showing this kind of agency, this kind of responsibility. And I would love to think that as we come back into a more formal setting and schools reopen again, that whatever that looks like, we don't lose what this is presenting for our pupils, because I think what this is doing is giving them great opportunities to have this, learning these new ways of working now in schools that is only going to equip them well for whenever they go into the world of work, where this will become increasingly the norm.
Thank you, Alistair. Thanks, Robbie, for those questions. I need to move us on to Nicola Brogan, MLA.
Thanks, Chair. Again, thanks, Nicole and Karen, for your presentations and for all the other contributions. I'll just echo what everyone else said, that both presentations themselves were brilliant, but all the work you've done to set this up has been outstanding, and we all really appreciate it. We can really see now, this is my first time meeting all of you, and I can see how important your work has been, because, you know, you're trying to reopen schools after the first lockdown, obviously was so difficult, and we depended on you to tell us how to do that there, you know. So thanks for that there. I'd just like to pick up on what Michael had said to Robbie there, and Nicole, you'd mentioned in your presentation too about the digital strategy. I think you're 100% right. We need to have something there, bring something forward to address the digital divide. And I think we've all brought to the attention of Minister Weir, like I said to him even yesterday in the Chamber's questions, you know, it's such a concern. Just like that disparity now among our young people, you know. So yeah, to address that, and obviously as mentioned earlier as well about ensuring that teachers receive the training they need to ensure that they can, you know, teach children essentially. Just one point I wanted to ask about, we have already touched on this too, but I suppose now we all know that even the last few years, but even more so since the pandemic, we know how important the use of digital technology is to children, and it's going to be to children. So I suppose I want to know, do you see this as an opportunity to invest and develop the use of digital technology to as a part of future delivery of education to your children?
In a word, yes. You know, out of a crisis comes opportunity, and you know, there is such an amazing, we're on the cusp of something, and I think that's what gets us so excited and why we are so optimistic, is because we can see that there is potential for something great here when the system works with the profession. And I might let or invite Louise there to talk a little bit more about some of the visions that we would have for a digital strategy, you know, one that works with teachers and with the providers.
Yeah, well, first of all, I suppose, as Nicole said in her presentation, that the TPL and teacher upskilling is vital, and the collaborative work between teachers and schools is brilliant at the minute. A digital portal or something along those lines where teachers can access everything in one place would be amazing. But we have to remember that what we're trying to do for our pupils is really to equip them with what they need for the world of work. Our goal ultimately with those skills and those things that we can future-proof is for them to be able to go with digital skills hand in hand with literacy and numeracy. As adults, we're now experiencing that, but it's very, very vital right from cradle to grave, from Pamela in nursery right through to Alistair at A-level and ourselves all in between, that we're all singing from the same hymn sheet, and that digital skills underpin other subjects, and they underpin, even now, underpin almost all jobs that children will eventually be applying for and creating. And there are so many jobs out there that haven't even been invented yet with the technology that exists. We need to be facilitators to provide those skills for our students.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Louise, and this is the best opportunity we have to do that there, so why not? I just finally want to ask about what kind of response you've all got from parents. I'm sure, I can imagine they're thrilled that they're, you know, the kind of work's taken off them. But what kind of response have you received from parents about this initiative?
I suppose we haven't directly trained parents, although it was something that we had discussed about, because parents have had to do a massive upskilling since March, whenever remote learning landed at their front doors and homeschooling. But from our practice and collaborative practices, I know for my own school, we surveyed parents at the end of our last period of remote learning and asked them, like, what did you think? What went well? What could go better? And then we took their feedback to feed into our next practice. And so far, touch wood, my parents have been incredibly, incredibly supportive, and they have thanked and said that the engagement compared to last time has been so much better, and that the content that we're providing has made their lives so much easier at home, because now some, you know, there's more parents are back into the office or back into work. You know, we're not, you know, they can maybe rely a little bit more on granny or granddad helping with childcare. But we've made it so accessible for them, for our school anyway. But Karen made such an important point that different schools have made different leaps based on the leadership that they've had, the resourcing they've had, and the upskilling they've had. So while I feel my school has taken a great jump in the right direction, other schools, through no fault of their own, haven't been able to get that far because they don't have the necessary resource and equipment.
Yeah. I can imagine that the parents in your schools are thrilled with that. But I suppose that's something we have to look at then, to again just address that kind of disparity, so that all schools can rise up to the same level. for this, and thanks very much to all of you for the presentations and discussion. Thanks, Chair.
Thanks, Nicola. Yeah, I think parental training and support is a key issue coming out of this as well, that we can come back to, and I suppose, and of course, pupil experience of blended learning. Can I bring in Justin McNulty, MLA?
Good afternoon, guys. I'm uplifted. I'm inspired. I'm mesmerized by all of you. Fantastic. It's incredible to sit on a committee and be inspired by people, by your enthusiasm, by your positivity, by your willingness to work together, the team culture, the team ethos, everyone in for the greater good. Phenomenal. Talk about leading by example for both kids and for teachers. And for society, phenomenal. Take a bow. Take a big, big bow, all of you. Unbelievable. Well done. You've mentioned creating a culture of sharing, right? And you know, you're talking about leading change, and you're doing that by your actions, by your very actions. You're doing that. And that's inspiring, as I said. And there are very specific parts of our education system which could take a leaf out of your book, to say it frankly. They could take a big, big leaf out of your book. And so again, well done. In terms of us as elected representatives and as members of the Education Committee, how can we help you? We've obviously got access to quite a significant reach across our social media platforms. And there are people, or there are probably possibly teachers out there who don't know about the work you're doing. How can we help you as elected representatives who've got a significant reach on social media?
Well, first of all, thank you so much for your kind words. As Karen had said, we didn't set out to train over 6,000 teachers so far. I suppose the support and help that we would love, I don't want to speak out of turn, so anybody can jump in for this one. But I suppose we would just love to be able to do this in a way that is sustainable. I mentioned that we're full-time teachers and we love the classroom. We're not looking to get out of the classroom anytime soon. But we definitely want to support people who need that support. We have fantastic statutory bodies who could be who could maybe be supporting teachers in collaboration with teachers. So I think what we would love to see is the likes of our like CIA or C2K or EA or the Creative Learning Centres or charities who provide teacher professional learning to do it alongside with teachers. Because just having that technical, here's how you push a button, here's how you do this, is good and that is needed. There are teachers who need that, but I've mentioned it before about that pedagogical backing and you need that classroom-based practice. And I just open it up to anybody else on the call here who wants to say, what do we want, what do you need?
Yeah, I'll maybe come in there and just talk a little bit more about that sense of collaboration system-wide. Whenever I'm training staff in our school, I like to talk about this principle called exemplified principles. We need to know why things work. Somebody said this great quotation, you don't need to know how and why your car works until it breaks down. If all we're doing is training teachers on what buttons to press, we're not equipping them properly to be able to actually use these for proper pedagogical point of view. So how then do we make sure that we're focusing on that? How do we upskill and something like that? I think part of what is bringing the great credibility, practitioners were teachers. So for the system to find some way of, and I use that phrase again, amplifying this voice, just getting those examples out there so that the teachers that maybe aren't that a little bit as far down the journey are getting a chance to hear it. The EA portal at the moment, as I've mentioned, is a great opportunity for that. And I think you're looking at something like the role of ETI at the moment. Michael commented on that, the shift in the role that ETI has played. And it's very interesting to compare what some teachers are saying about inspectorates in other parts of the United Kingdom, where it is not quite so positive. I have to say the experience of working with these agencies for me has been incredibly positive. But here's my challenge moving forward. What does it look like when we come out of the other side? Because you know what's happened here? Over the last year or so, whenever there has been no direct accountability into schools through the likes of ETI, what's happened is a number of teachers and a number of schools have stepped up. So I think it gives us a chance to reflect on how we bring about positive change within the education system as a whole. Is it all about top-down accountability, saying, are you doing this? Are you doing this? Because I tell you what, that tends to lead to compliance to box ticking. Or is it about collaboration together, all the system, all the parts of the system saying, right, where are the interesting things that are happening? Let's amplify that. Let's create the synergy between those people and let's just get this positivity and this message out there. And we said a number of times we are resolutely optimistic, but let's try to imagine a system where the collaboration together says, what can we do together to make this better? So that was supposed the challenge up to you folks on the Education Committee. The Minister has said that he wants a different relationship between ETI and schools, things like that, where you have an opportunity to influence the way in which the system is structured to promote this teamwork and this collaboration is certainly something that could be helpful.
Alistair, just before I bring Justin back in, we have ETI waiting to join us in our next session conveniently. So, but let me bring Justin back in there before we move on to that session. Thanks, Justin.
Okay, and I know you've got limited time, guys. I know, but in terms of your experience with parental involvement, what's your feedback? And also, what's your experience in terms of rural communities where some children, some families don't have access to that broadband connectivity that is necessary to avail of the digital resources that you're speaking about very positively today?
Yeah, I'm going to hand that one straight to Louise, as she is out in the sticks, so she could speak credibly to that.
Wi-Fi can certainly be an issue. Actually, in our local area around Cull Island, it is very, very patchy when you get out right out to the Loch Shore. 4G, a lot of our students would rely on 4G or very intermittent broadband. We have had occasions where students right down to the Loch Shore around Bracca direction have had actually to go to other people's houses or to go to local hubs where they can sit in their car to upload work. Now, to be fair, that was mainly in the last lockdown, but I'm sure those people have just found workarounds. I know Michael, I'm going to maybe bring him in on this. He's also quite rural, and as a principal, he maybe has more guidance on what his ALC or his cluster is doing with that.
Thanks, Louise, and thanks, Justin. I suppose it's probably echoing what's been mentioned here previously about Wi-Fi and connectivity. We are sort of rural and in a village and a town, if you know what I mean. We sort of stretch out, if anybody knows where Craig Ballon Park direction is in North Derry, Aaron Mullen is not too far away from Derry City there. And we've been able to access as a school, those sort of dongles and things from T2K as such, and they've been very, very helpful. Some of those things have taken a while to come, but again, that's not a department of SU or a T2K issue. I think that's more a sort of worldwide sort of approach to supply and technology at the moment. But I think it really just boils down to support, Justin, picking up the phone and speaking to parents, dropping in to see how they're getting on. The guys in Blendin and I here and myself, we make videos for our school to show people how to log on, how to access, even delving into pedagogy as well, how to sort of support learning at home for parents. So again, you can have all the technology you want, but I think just pick up the phone, speak to parents and see how you can support them that way. That's a good way to start.
Thanks for that. Okay,
one quick question. The only safe ship in a storm is leadership, and you folk have shown extraordinary leadership. Well done.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Justin. Okay, Karen, Nicole, Louise, Michael, Pamela, John, Alistair, and Alistair's dog, thank you so much for your invaluable evidence this morning. I'm sorry that we can't take more time with you, but really, really invaluable evidence. We do have a session now with ETI, so we will do all we can as a committee to support your work and support the extension of the good practice that you've been involved with right across our education system for all pupils and all families in Northern Ireland. And we'll keep in touch with you on this really important matter. Yeah, who's that?
Sorry, it's John. Whenever you're speaking to them, could you push forward a voice to have teachers' voices in there? Because all these bodies are very good at supporting in their own ways, but you're always going to get that insular view. And the like of us talking about this digital strategy, both trust, like we're both charitable entities, so we have similar endeavors, although we represent different people and different demographics, We want a strategy. We want teachers' voices at the forefront of that. We want that collaboration. To think, for example, the nurseries, there's 707 nurseries who make up 41% of all schools in Northern Ireland, and they have no connection to C2K whatsoever, and they have no connection between that. If we were using, as been mentioned over and over again about the digital portal, if we brought in the seesaw for schools, as we're suggesting at Goliath here, across all sectors, including first year, not even including first year, actually, of secondary schools, post-primaries make up 11% of all schools in Northern Ireland. If you brought that in, you would have, we would want all key stakeholders involved in there. We would want our ETIs in there. We want our therapists in there. We would want our link officers in there. We'd want our EWOs in there. We'd want the EA in there, and give us that voice and that repository to actually to share that excellent practice that, you know, is there. And the skill set is phenomenal. But that builds on what Nicole's saying about the positive opportunity that we have here. Instead of us always being the wee backward lot between two islands and two entities and two constituencies, we could actually be leaders here. We could be a Northern Ireland wide leader and show what has potential here. There's examples there from other jurisdictions, but actually we could actually take that even further if we were involved at those key sessions. We were actually getting to have our voices aired. So thank you very much to all of you for actually giving us our voice today.
I think hopefully ETI have just heard you as well as us. So that's a great way to close. John, thank you everybody for your contributions today. We look forward to keeping in touch with you on this matter. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair, and from everybody here. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, thanks, can I ask Assembly Broadcasting to remove all witnesses and add all members back into the spotlight and keep them there until the end of this session. Can I ask the clerk to summarise actions from that briefing? And I would say that the first clear action members is for the committee to write to the EACEO, Sarah Long, to support the urgent progress on provision of funded seesaw to nursery special school and primary schools in Northern Ireland. Members agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, Clark?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I would have just been also proposing to reflect some of the other aspects of that briefing, namely the committee's absolute delight with the witnesses and the calls for digital equality, first of all, and a digital strategy, an associated portal, lots of teachers' voices in the development of the strategy, addressing disparity not just through upskilling teachers and addressing teacher training needs, but also parents and grandparents in the background, proposing the merits then of seesaw for nursery, primary and special schools, having a district library of shared superb resources, as Goliath put it, and making support like this a standard service to teachers rather than something that is being offered on a voluntary basis. And also then there was a proposal that partners in creative learning charities, CCEA and C2K, could work together in providing classroom-based practice.
I think the parental experience and the pupil experience of remote and blended learning is something that we'll want to look at as a committee as well, but we can come back to that. Members content with those actions? I'm keen to bring the ETI representatives in as soon as possible here.
Yeah.
Members content?
Content.
Any other questions or comments? No? Happy with those actions? That's great. Okay, members, if I could ask Assembly Broadcasting, and thank you, Clark, for that, if I could ask Assembly Broadcasting to remove all members from the spotlight and to add our ETI witnesses. Can I refer members to a briefing note from the committee clerk at page 32, an ETI report, examples of approaches to learning and teaching during COVID-19 recovery phase at page 34, and can I welcome Faustina Graham, Chief Inspector of the Education and Training Inspectorate, Raymond Caldwell, Assistant Chief Inspector, Heather Jackson, Managing Inspector Primary, Gillian Boyd, Managing Inspector Special Education, Sinead McKenna, Managing Inspector Post-Primary. Can I apologise, witnesses, for the delay in getting to you today, but hopefully maybe you were able to listen to some of our last session and some positive references to the ETI in there as well to encourage you. And we look forward to being able to engage with you on this important matter of digital learning as well then today. Can I advise officials that you have 10 minutes to make an opening statement, and then we'll take questions from members. Thank you. Faustina, I think you might still be on mute there. Apologies. No? I'm not hearing you. No. Clark, can we check with Assembly Broadcasting if there's a, that the witnesses have been brought into the spotlight and the audio there, okay?
They are. So if the one person presenting can have their mic on and the other's not, there's quite a lot of feedback just now.
I can't hear Faustina. Can Clark, can you hear? No.
Good morning. Can you hear any of us?
Yes.
This is Sinead McKenna. Just good morning, everyone. Could I just maybe suggest to my colleagues, if you don't mind, in the COG under settings, if you perhaps check for the drop down and try for settings to an output, that might help you. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks for that, Sinead. We're still adjusting to the various platforms available to us for these purposes.
I think what happens for ETI is we move between all of the different platforms, depending who we're engaging with, and it knocks our settings off.
Understand.
Chair, I suspect that Faustina might have to log out and log back in again.
Okay.
Maybe go straight maybe to questions, and we can pick up maybe the conversation, and then Faustina can pick up on the opening remarks whenever she connects back in. Would that be possible?
Yeah, no problem, Raymond. Maybe I could start us then just by asking, is it worth someone there from ETI kind of setting out concisely the role of the inspectorate in terms of remote and blended learning?
Happy to do so. Chair, I mean, if we look back, first of all, to the initial lockdown, whenever inspections paused, and ETI district inspectors undertook the cross-organisation link officer role that you'll be familiar with and was referred to earlier by our colleagues and Glenda and I. And that really focused on specifically providing support for key worker children, but importantly, discussing the skills for remote learning being delivered. It led to a series of publications quite early on in 2020, and then periodically throughout, I guess, almost a year now, where we have been working alongside, working cooperatively with, importantly, whenever the schools reopened as we move through the initial recovery phase, there was an opportunity there to extend our district inspector activity to resume it across all phases, to continue in preschool, primary and post-primary, and really to gain that first-hand evidence of what was working well in regards to remote learning, to provide advice, to share case studies and examples of good practice with schools, but also to identify the challenges that schools were facing. And in turn, that has enabled us to provide policy advice to the department and other players. And that work is ongoing, Chair. I mean, we're currently, we've issued a survey that went out to schools that opened on Monday to focus specifically in the current lockdown on high schools, and really the nature and extent of the remote learning, and really building on the evidence that we've already received from schools that really they're much better placed and have really stepped up, and that's an absolute credit to all of our teachers and leaders, and indeed in terms of the resilience that they've shown. So that survey is ongoing. It will allow us to report on the nature and extent, and alongside that, we're engaging with schools in a partnership way and working to really look at the extent to which that remote learning is being monitored at whole school level and how the quality of the remote learning is being monitored. And so that's really, in a nutshell, what our current role is in terms of working alongside, identifying practice, sharing practice, reporting at a system level and in a thematic way, but importantly, identifying what's working well and also what the challenges are.
Okay. Thank you, Raymond. Faustina, can you hear us now? There you go.
We can hear you now. Great. Sorry. It was just, as Sinead said, our microphones are particularly difficult at times.
No problem.
So, Chair, do you want me to go ahead with opening remarks, or do you just want to open up the discussion? Because, you know, I mean, I was going to say, I did obviously listen to the last session, and, you know, and everything that I think those teachers were saying, we could probably say yes to in so many ways. So I'm happy to go ahead with this if you want, or alternatively to open up the discussion if you think that's more beneficial for your...
Our time is short. Do you want to make any short, concise references or responses to maybe some of the issues that you heard, and we will move into questions probably, yeah?
Happy to do that. I mean, I did want to make reference, Chair, and some of our colleagues there did make reference to the fact that clearly there hasn't been inspection for a considerable amount of time. And so therefore, my colleagues over the last period of time have been working instead with the system, using their expertise as originally COVID-19 link officers, obviously, but more recently then over the autumn term, moving back into their more formal role as district inspectors and combining that then with the role of the link officer. So I think that's really been the approach that ETI has taken over that period of time. And I suppose what was reflected in that last exchange, and it was really delightful for me to hear that as well, is that this has been a period of rebuilding relationships, I think, you know, after a very difficult period of action short of strike. And rightly, I think, then the pause in inspection that there has been because of the pandemic. So I would have to say that I'm truly appreciative of the constructive and open way that teachers and skill leaders have engaged with inspectors over that period of time. And again, listening to colleagues talking about approaching new ways of working and looking at different ways of working, that's certainly something that we as an organisation are looking at now. Obviously, working with our minister also to look at how we move forward with inspection in the future. But importantly, I think the one thing I do want to really touch on, and I think our speaker said it more eloquently than I would do, was really in relation to the whole area of digital learning. And I really wanted to echo what Nicole in particular said about the importance and that emphasis of the access to digital devices and high quality resources for children. But ultimately, more importantly, I think what they really stressed was the importance of high quality professional learning for our teachers. And I think that for me, in terms of touching on anything that I think is really important as we move forward, is the top priority. Because as Nicole herself said, I think it is about what teachers do with that digital technology, how the pedagogy actually develops over time, which is absolutely crucial. I want to say as Chief Inspector that our teachers moved at an incredible pace in upskilling in relation to digital learning. Those colleagues talked about the fact that they had the advantage of being further ahead because their schools had that cutting edge approach to the development of ICT within their curricular provision. But equally, they talked about other people struggling with that at the beginning. So I think all credit to our teachers and to our school leaders in the way that they have moved forward, because I would hope that even yourselves in the conversations that you have with school leaders and with teachers will see that visible growth in confidence from where we started in March 2020 to where we are today in terms of the second lockdown, and the confidence and the assurance that teachers are dealing with that. That doesn't take away, I think, from the fact that that has taken tremendous effort to do so. And therefore, teachers do now need time and space to actually consolidate that learning. And I think, again, that's echoing the various stages that colleagues who were on the previous call talked about that teachers are at in this journey, along really becoming confident and competent in that whole world of digital technology. There are people now who have mastered the technical side of that. I thought it was fascinating to listen to Alistair talking just about the changes that he sees in his students now as a result of him spending more time doing this. Sometimes I think we have been in danger of talking about remote learning as meaning no learning. And I think we have to begin to address what are the ways in which there can be advantageous gains for our education system by using technology efficiently. we probably, in fairness, were lagging behind as an education system in terms of some of our use of ICT in the past. As colleagues said on that previous call, we have an opportunity now to actually be leaders in that whole area. We're a small system, and I think, therefore, we should always have the opportunity to get things right and to do things effectively. Certainly, I will give that that commitment to those colleagues that, from an ETI perspective, we absolutely want to work collaboratively with everyone that we can in terms of helping and supporting the system to move forward. One of the ways, I suppose, that I wanted to talk about this morning really in doing that is that, that colleagues have really focused on supporting schools over the last period of time. Our key work is probably, and our key skill is probably, in evaluation. And I think that's where I would like us to move to over the next period of time. Now, that again takes a degree of trust from our educators to know that in working collaboratively with them, that it is to allow us to learn alongside them and to extract the lessons really from what they are experiencing, that we can use them to inform our entire education system in ways that we can develop the digital approach to all of our learning, even if we are back in a face-to-face environment, more comprehensively. So I absolutely would give that commitment to those colleagues. But I think for us, you will be aware that we issued a questionnaire just this week. We are about to publish individual phase reports for preschool, for primary, post-primary, youth, AODIS, further education and work-based learning, all tracking the changes that have taken place over the last period of time, and to use that as a starting point really to begin to build by the end of the year to a more evaluative approach to what has happened at system level. I think that's the unique role that ETI can play, in the sense that we are professional evaluators, but again, not in a punitive way. I think it is very much the idea of ETI coming alongside our schools over the next period of time and really trying to learn with them and capture, as colleagues said in the last call, capture the learning that has taken place and actually disseminating that across the system. So I think any role we can play, we are willing to stand ready and do that. And also just to say that, you know, how do I follow what you just heard, in the sense that certainly listening to those colleagues reminded me exactly why I loved being a teacher. So thank you to all of them for the work that they do and for their colleagues, because I did also find it inspirational, I must say. They said they were optimists. I thought, yeah, absolutely, all good teachers are ultimately optimists and have to continue to believe. So thank you, Chair. Sorry, that's a real rush through what I was going to say. But
no, thank you, Christina. Hopefully this will be an ongoing engagement with yourself, so we'll have more time at future dates as well. But let me bring members in, and I'll go to Deputy Chairperson Karen Mullen, MLA.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you everybody for joining us. I know we're very tight for time, so I'm going to try and go over this. Christina, you're right, the previous session was very uplifting, and very, very passionate group. With a lot of valuable information and learning that they've collected, particularly over the last year. So we hope that the department very much takes on board that, because there's a group of people who want to provide the solutions and also the learning over the period. Even though some of our members here was trying to corner them, but they handled it very well. So it was great to see you. We come from the glass half empty. But I suppose just to go back, I know that we talked there around the digital inequality across, and we focus quite a bit in the committee because we're still not where we need to be around the IT devices. And it's very disappointing for me that in March last year, I think the first week or two we went under this pandemic, I raised it on the floor of the Assembly with the Minister in relation to devices. And 10 months later, we still haven't even tackled that. We haven't provided that support, and we're now here, and it could be mid to end February, even in this next round. So as predicted, children could be back in school. We're also hearing, I suppose, in terms of and we heard it very clearly this morning, around the disparity around the workforce in schools
And again, for me, I got caught up very focused in around the IT equipment, what schools had, what teachers had. But the group this morning just brought me back to, it's the teacher behind the screen and the skills and the upskilling that she needs, or she and he, the whole workforce needs as well. So just on the point when we were chatting to John around the CISO package, Christina, is that something that yourselves would be very much passionate about? It would be critical that we ensure that all our schools, highlighted this morning, nursery, primary and special schools, have that?
I think, I suppose, Karen, what I would say is I have to be a little bit more cautious than our previous colleagues were, as they said, they have the freedom to talk about whatever they want to talk about with regard to various packages. Ultimately, CISO is a commercial package, and I think, you know, therefore for me to say I'm endorsing that as what should be used in every school would be very difficult to say. What I can say is the functionality that they have described there absolutely is something that we would endorse in terms of certainly my colleagues seeing over the last period of time how that has been used effectively, and I think there's no doubt about that. So it is all of the elements, I think, that they've described that they have named within CISO, I think would certainly be the type of application that C2K would be pursuing, and I think they refer to that as well. So I think one of the things is really trying, and I suppose I would say this to you as a committee, I listened to colleagues from DE this morning talking about finance as well, and I have a little bit more freedom than I have when I was working as a director in the department to speak this way. But I think one of the difficulties, I think, and I think you have a platform to make some difference there, is that I watch my civil service colleagues and colleagues in the EA, and they drown in the bureaucracy of all of the issues around procurement and tendering and, as they said, monitoring money, etc. And somewhere along the line, I think there has to be a degree of pragmatism around allowing things to happen efficiently and effectively for schools, because they need it, as you say, 10 months on. Probably something arriving in 10 months seems actually quite fast and quite efficient from the bureaucracy side of it, whereas from your perspective, as you said, Karen, and from my perspective and a teacher sitting in the classroom, that feels like it's much too late. And I think it is about exploring ways of actually ensuring that things can get to where they are needed quickly, and in some ways trying to explore ways of minimising the degree of bureaucracy that surrounds that, whether that is in the schools having to monitor or to justify what they're doing subsequently, but without in any way wasting public money. And that's a really difficult challenge for anyone to achieve. But it is, I think, the challenge that we face. And I have seen it from both perspectives, Karen, and that's why I'm saying I think it is a bit like what our colleagues were saying earlier. It is only through working collaboratively and working together that we will find solutions to any of those issues. So, you know, I think you can be of a help to the education system there in terms of the role that all of you play.
Yeah, agree, Faustina. It is difficult, and then managing the 1 year budget as well, as we heard this morning, and carrying over and all of that there. But then when we look at the educational disparity across all of this, and 41%, it's not connected. Just finally, look, Chris, Faustina, you had touched on it. Just around, I wanted to ask around your role as inspectorates in ensuring a consistent level of effective remote learning across the school network. You said there around the survey, and you also touched in terms of the link officers. Is there anything else that you are doing or plan to do?
I think, Karen, we have been in that difficult situation, and, you know, Alistair talked about the change in our relationship. When you have formal inspection, then you always have an evidence base of how the system is performing right across the piece. And there is a need for us to get back to that world where we can actually evaluate consistency and evaluate it at individual school level. But clearly we have to do that in a way that is constructive, and that brings people with us. And you see from the interaction with colleagues this morning how that can work effectively when that is done. So there is a bit of work for us still to do there. What we are reliant on at the minute is those relationships that my colleagues have built up with the various schools. So
So we have inspectors working as district inspectors again, who, when they see something that doesn't appear to be right, will challenge that, but will challenge that quietly within the arena of that individual school. It's not something that has been made public, but I can give you that assurance that as my colleagues returned to their role of district inspectors, that support and challenge function is back again, in the sense that first and foremost, we have to act in the interests of children and young people. So anything that suggests there is underperformance in a school is obviously something that we would continue to look at. In terms of consistency, I've said there that we are about to publish some reports within the next couple of weeks, and those are for each individual phase, charting what happened pre-COVID and then charting what has happened in the first lockdown and through the autumn term. And what we want to do then with that is actually over the upcoming period of time, build on that work then, and actually by the end of this academic year, begin to get a picture of what is the consistency, as you say, across the education system. And I think that would leave us, Karen, in a way that we're prepared to move forward. I think we've got to look strategically at the future as well. And I think that's part of the role that we can play and part of the way we can support the system by doing that. Now, as I say, some of that also takes our colleagues in schools having the courage to invite us to look at what they're doing. And there's no reason why all of those colleagues this morning shouldn't do that, because clearly the work they're doing is so good. We've had some experience over last term of working in CAFRI, the agricultural college, of actually being able to evaluate the quality of online learning, because they took that brave step and asked us to do so. So that's where we want to get to, where we can share that learning with the colleagues, with our teaching colleagues, to actually learn together in the way that our previous presenters talked about this morning.
Okay.
Christina, thank you. And I'm hearing, I would very much welcome the supportive approach, and I am hearing more positive things. So good luck to you and the team. Thanks very much, Chair.
Thank you very much, Karen.
Thanks, Karen. Can I bring in Daniel McCrossan, MLA?
He's like me.
Daniel, are you there okay? Okay, while Daniel gets sorted, let me go to Robbie Butler, MLA.
Hi, Chair. Yep, thank you, guys.
Thanks, Robbie.
Thanks so much for your time. And as the Chair said, thank you so much for your patience. I don't have too much to ask, guys. I think you've been pretty good in terms of the report you've given and how you've outlined things. But I do have one concern, however. Now, it's not the future concern, it's a concern that we have now, and that is the educational gap, the inequalities, and the gap that pertains to academic attainment and so on. So whilst there's been some fabulous examples of remote learning and there's some fabulous use of IT and equipment and stuff, has there been any scoping or thought given to any potential this would have for widening that gap at the moment, when we know that poverty and access to equipment and that other additional support is also a factor? And if that is the case, are there any suggestions for how we mitigate those risks going forward? Because these cohorts of pupils who are going through this COVID pandemic is undoubtedly an issue with lost face-to-face learning and how we're going to address that post-COVID.
And totally accept what you're saying there about the difficulties and the complexities around that. I think certainly our view would be that, you know, that we have a curriculum in Northern Ireland which is a very forward and progressive curriculum. It is a curriculum in which there is minimum prescription, really, to allow that really very holistic look at how children develop. And how they develop their skills as well as their knowledge and understanding. And so I think the inspectorate and certainly the department also were very clear in September, going back to school at that point in time, that it would be about using our curriculum and the flexibility in that curriculum to assess where children were at in their learning at that point in time, and to allow that then to allow teachers to move forward confidently in helping children to learn further. Because I think sometimes the concept of loss of learning, I think, suggests a real deficit and something that can actually demotivate our pupils even further, rather than actually assessing where they're at. I'll maybe ask Heather just to talk briefly, because certainly in the primary sector, I know in the report that's about to issue schools were actually reassured that there wasn't as much concern around loss of learning as they anticipated there might be at that point in time. So I'll maybe ask Heather just to comment as primary managing inspector.
Hello, Chair and committee members. Certainly, what we our district inspectors on their visits throughout September, December have found that schools, teachers and schools know their pupils, and they've been putting in mitigating factors to identify those children for whatever reason there may be a gap in their learning. And it's important that we recognise that in schools. For example, a number of schools chose to have their children from the summer term into the autumn term and kept their children in that bubble up until Halloween, so they would have the familiarity of their teachers and expertise, and that they would assess the children in readiness and setting plans in place in that respect. Furthermore, they also, the priorities, and many, whilst they had the return to school, the safety of safe return to school, they established new routines for children to enhance the health and safety issues, but they also dealt very carefully with the pastoral needs of the children through asking the children about their attitude to school and to set programmes in place. They also very much developed a system of identifying what were the gaps in the learning, and certainly from our report, which will be published shortly, will be the foundation stage teachers have identified that there's a need for further work on the expressive language, especially years 1 and 2, and for the Irish medium as well. That's important that that's been identified. They are prioritising areas around reading and early phonics work in the foundation stage, because as you can imagine, to do it remotely with the younger children is much more difficult, and therefore that engagement in class has been vital from September to December for schools to do that. And they are consequently during this lockdown setting up systems through asynchronous and synchronous pre-recorded and live sessions to talk and to teach their children aspects of reading, and they've brought parents involved as well. Other areas, certainly in Key Stage 2, would be actually aspects of maths, practical maths would be areas. But again, we need to recognise that schools have done this assessment of their children in September, October time, and they've set their plans in place and they're addressing that as well. And equally, through the Engage programme, schools have identified not just children who would have been perhaps on an at-risk register as regards learning, but they have also identified children who didn't engage through the first lockdown. So it's a mixture of children that have been identified, and certainly schools are in a good place this time, as previous Blend Ed colleagues indicated, of addressing those issues as well, and as Christina has reinforced as well.
Brilliant. I look forward to that report, because I do fear that there will be sort of a disparity of how this has affected and supported some children across the country, not to take anything away from the hard work the teachers have put in. Just very, very final one, guys. We had a significant debate in the plenary yesterday with regard to special schools and special education needs. So it's been often said that a lot of this sort of interactive online learning doesn't really sit well for some children, maybe with an additional need. Has there been any work done for special education needs kids in the schools with regard to what we may be able to develop, or have there been areas of good practice in that sector?
Okay, and Robbie, I'll ask Shane Boyd, who is over managing inspector for special educational needs, to maybe comment on that for you then.
Jill, I didn't think we can hear Gillian, sorry. That's a shame.
No, you can't actually. And well, you know, certainly I know, yes, absolutely there is, and Gillian would be able to talk very comprehensively about that, Robbie, and certainly we're happy to come back and give you more detail. I mean, Gillian is a former special school principal,
that would be grand if we get
the knowledge on it. So there will be a report emanating in the next couple of weeks as well, then certainly with regard to special educational aid. She's going to try and come in again, but maybe if you want to move on and come back.
We'll move on, but certainly if she's able to come back in, that's a really important question from Robbie there.
Yeah.
Robbie, you content if Gillian comes back for me to bring you back in at that point?
Absolutely, Chair. Thank you so much. Thanks, guys.
Okay. Thanks, Robbie. Is Daniel McCrossan there? His door is. And it's a proud copy of the agreement, but I need Daniel. Okay, I'll move on. Nicola Brogan, MLA. Thanks, Nicola.
Thank you. Thanks again for all of you for coming and answering our questions today. Faustina, I agree with you that teachers and school leaders deserve real credit. I don't think any of us should forget or underestimate just how difficult the response to COVID was and continues to be in all sectors. But I think all of us here, I know we all agree just how important the education sector is and how important it is to try and continue the education of our young people in whatever manner. Again, as we said it a number of times, that it's best for the children to have to be educated through face-to-face learning, but you know, just the way things are, we have to make the best of it. I'd just like to come back to the point Robbie had made and Karen had picked up on as well. Not to be negative, I know the presentations from Blenda was really positive, and that's a great thing, but like, I have been approached by a number of people concerned about the quality of the education their children are getting since the latest restrictions have come in, both, you know, even the supervisation, they feel it's just been supervised when, with the children of key workers who are at school and vulnerable children who are at school, and then those who are receiving remote learning. So I don't know, can you just outline kind of exactly how you are inspecting that and what provisions you're putting in place to ensure that they are receiving equal kind of standards of education, please?
Yeah, and as I said earlier, and apologies because I wasn't able to go into the detail of my actual speaking notes at that point in time, but I suppose it's just to say that from March of last year, inspection has been paused, so we are not conducting formal inspection at this point in time. Our district inspectors are working with schools, and they started in March last year working as the cross organisational link officers, and over the autumn term then started working again as district inspectors. So within individual schools, those conversations are taking place, Nicola, around what is on offer for children. But equally, there is a limit to that from our perspective, because while normally we will look in detail at all of the work that is being provided, we are reliant on what the school is saying is happening. Now, the other part of that, I think it is important, and you heard those professionals talking this morning, it is important to remember that children at different stages of their education will have different styles of work will be appropriate for them, or even different amounts of time to spend online, etc. All of those things. And certainly my colleagues at the beginning of the pandemic actually produced guidance materials at that point in time, which gives a sense of how often a child should be engaged, particularly in something like online activity. There's nothing that we have seen that suggests categorically that any one approach is better than another approach with regard to how children are learning. So while we encourage people to use the technology, if schools are not using that or are using a different approach, the important thing is effective learning. We are aware, obviously, also, you know, I'm sure you've talked to people where maybe the approaches between different teachers, even in the same school, can be different. And the really important thing, I think, there is for parents to communicate with the school and to have their fears discussed with the school in that way. I get worried at times that sometimes we're in danger of setting our parents up in contention with our schools, and that to me would be a complete and utter disaster. I think what we probably still need to do some work on in education for all of us, in the way our colleagues talked about previously, is supporting our schools to support parents. I think that's part of the work that we still probably need to do. I think we're happy to start being involved in any way we can in that work as well too, because I think this to me is ultimately about communication. And then if that communication does not actually ensure that a parent is satisfied in that instance, then you're starting to look at something different. But I think it is because of the circumstances we're in that sometimes there is that lack of clarity, and I think we still have a job to do around supporting parents.
No, of course, Christina, and I fully appreciate the fact that because the times you're in, it is very difficult for you to carry out that role. I do understand that, and that's not an attack. It's just as they
have been. No, absolutely. I would prefer that we could, but I think we have to be sensitive to the circumstances at this point in time.
Absolutely. I just want to pick up on a point from the briefing paper about outdoor learning. There seems to be a lot of benefits from that there. Are you, I know that's at the minute, that's kind of a result of COVID and restrictions, but are there any plans to incorporate that into future learning for children?
Okay, well, I'm probably going to ask Heather again simply because it is mostly at this point in time where we've been exploring it in the primary sector. And I think there's been some lovely work, certainly, that I've seen it, and you may have seen yourself, but Heather is obviously the authority on that area. So if Heather wants to speak to that.
Yes, certainly. The emphasis schools have put an emphasis on outdoor learning simply because they see the value of any physical activity to develop the mental and emotional well-being of the children. And as Faustina has said, it's about screen time, being away from screen time. And equally in the Northern Ireland curriculum, there is an opportunity for exploring areas of the curriculum outdoor and maximising that. And because of the physical restrictions in some schools, that has become a priority. May also say that there was mention earlier about the transition from preschool into foundation stage. That has been an emphasis by ETI over the last number of years in the preschool team into the foundation stage about the development of outdoor learning. It's nothing, it's not new, but it has had the emphasis and it is coming now to the fore that that was the correct approach to take. So it really is about building on what is already existing good practice, and colleagues in preschool and equally in primary, and obviously, you know, in post-primary and special, will be able to develop that further. But schools have recognised that and they're coming up with many creative ways of developing the curriculum outdoors.
Okay.
That's great. Thank you for that, Heather, and thanks, Chair.
Thanks for that, Nicola. It might be of interest to know that we've established an all-party group on parental participation in education at the Assembly. And I think, obviously, the pandemic has highlighted a lot of issues, but I think it has absolutely highlighted the centrality of, and importance of parental capacity, empowerment to participate in education. And I definitely think that's something we need to give more attention to. But allow me to bring in Justin McNulty, MLA.
Do you want to see if Gillian's microphone's working as well? Maybe just there.
Yeah, sure. Gillian, any different? I don't think so. No, sorry. Sorry. We'll definitely try and re-engage with you on that important issue of remote learning in a special educational needs context.
Yes, absolutely.
Justin.
Happy to do so.
No problem. Justin?
Hey, guys. You're welcome to committee today, and thank you very much for your efforts. In terms of the previous group who we were all inspired by, they said start with why. And the why around ETA is around promoting improvement. In terms of any evidence you have of the pressure on schools due to COVID, do you have any views on a potential recharge program for kids to catch up emotionally, to catch up academically, to catch up mentally, to catch up in terms of the socialization, to catch up in terms of their physical health as well, their physical development? Do you have a view on that?
I heard you talking about that earlier, and I think obviously, as Heather has alluded to, I think it's really important that we assess as well what it is that we need to catch up on. I think there's something around us looking at where our children at in their learning and using that as a starting point and taking it forward from there. In terms of what you're talking about around recharging, I think anything for me that is going to be new and different, I think we've got to look at planning it carefully. Because if it's not planned carefully, then in actual fact, it can end up being counterproductive. So one of the ways I would suggest that we can do that is really we have been commissioned to evaluate the Engage programme. And the Engage programme obviously has been designed to try and allow for innovative and creative ways to looking at the whole area of catch up when children actually need it, where and customising that to their particular needs. So I would like to think that we will be able to accrue learning from that. That would allow us to build on that in due course. And to be honest with you, in my position, anything which means more money coming into our schools and our education system, I think is always going to be welcome. So if there is a way that we can look at a programme that will allow us to do that, so much the better. But it has to be a programme
that builds on the learning that we have already accrued. I think you've heard this morning, even in the first session, money of itself does not actually create improvement. Sometimes that money can't always be spent. It has to be about really looking at what children have learned, assessing what that learning is, and assessing the need then that arises from that. Ultimately, going back to what Nicole said earlier, it is about equipping our teachers with the skills that they need in order to deliver in the classroom. And I think the more we can do that and the more confident we can make our teachers, the better our outcomes will be.
Okay, well, I don't have any empirical evidence, but I know there's a widening educational gap. I just know that from talking to parents. I know that from children coming from disadvantaged backgrounds. So how do you intend to assess where kids are at on the resumption of teaching in classrooms? And you know, I know it's not about pouring money in, but in terms of what the previous group talked about, collaborating for the greater good, to raise all children up, to raise every boat up, how can we all buy into a recharge program that focuses very much on doing that?
I think you're right. It won't be about me assessing children. It will be about their teachers assessing their learning. The classroom teacher is the person who is best placed to assess any child's learning. Every child is an individual and every child will need a customised approach to how they progress and how they move forward. So I hadn't thought about what you described this morning in terms of a programme like that. I don't think there's any reason why we can't think about that. You know, I think it really is about how things move forward now in the future, insofar as thinking strategically about that, and if we can contribute to it, we absolutely will.
And one last quick question, Faustina. In terms of teachers, and we're all talking about remote learning and online learning, how the hell are teachers managing to do it, to do remote learning and at the same time teach children in the classroom? How are they coping? How are teachers and staff and assistants?
Currently, I think that it is highly complex and highly demanding. And that's why whenever I was speaking in my opening remarks, I said that, you know, many of our teachers have now mastered the technical side of what they need to do, but they do need time and space in order to actually ensure that they feel confident about what they are learning about how children learn. And some of that inevitably is they're doing, as our teacher said this morning, they're having to do that under pressure, because while there has been money allocated to substitute teachers and to allowing that additional input and resource into our schools, the reality is the situation that we're in means that even where we believe we have a surplus of teachers in Northern Ireland, we're still not able to meet that demand across all of our schools at the moment. So there are no easy answers, I think, at the moment to that. I think we're all trying to endure, and I think we are trying to celebrate, as we have done, what our teachers are actually managing to achieve. But that is at a cost. There is no doubt about that.
Keep going, Faustina. Best of luck.
Thank you very much. Thank you. We've lost you. Sorry, I've lost...
I neglected to unmute myself there, apologies.
I thought it was Megan.
Thanks for reminding me. That brings us to the end of the members that we have with us today. I realise we've pushed time almost as far as we can as well. We're extremely grateful for the time that you've all given us today. I think there are issues there that we want to stay engaged with you on, particularly in relation to that important question about the impact of remote learning in the special educational needs context, and maybe when some more of those reports come forward as well, that would be a pertinent time to re-engage with you on this important issue. But thank you so much for your time.
We'll send copies to you once those are published, but certainly very happy to re-engage with you at that point in time. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Can I ask Assembly Broadcasting to remove all witnesses and add all members back into the spotlight, and ask the clerk to summarise any other actions from the briefing?
Members, that briefing was positively received, and it seems that the ETI are going to report in due course on some of the issues that were raised. You may wish to write to them commending their constructive approach at the moment, and recommending the proposal that Justin was making about the RePower programme, where Faustina accepted that, you know, that was something that the ETI hadn't thought of just yet, but there was no reason why not, and that it was strategically an interesting direction to go in, and they would contribute. Also, there was a question about outdoor, a re-emphasis of outdoor work in schools at all levels, and you might want to find out a bit more about how that's playing out in the older school population.
Yeah, I don't want to sound in any way negative, but I know that it was received positively, but I think there are still some ongoing concerns from some of the questions that were asked, so I might just want to take care as to how content we sound with the approach at this moment in time. I do think we can solve some of the questions in terms of expressing at some point in time wanting to see a further assessment of the impact of remote learning and school closure on educational attainment, a more robust evaluation of the impact of the Engage programme on mitigating against any learning deficit, and what other interventions are being considered, and I think that ties in with what Ruslan has said in terms of catch up for academic, physical, and emotional development. Indeed, we ran out of time there, but the ETI was about to commence a review of physical education, and obviously the physical, can you still hear me, by the way? Yeah. Yep. For physical education is probably one of the most challenging to maintain in the context of school closure and remote learning. So it would be useful if we could maybe get some update from ETI in that regard as well. Members want to add to those actions in any way? Nope. Content. Okay. Members agreed with those actions? Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Members, then, if I can move to agenda item 8, correspondence, and ask the clerk to speak to our correspondence.
Okay, so a summary note on the correspondence is at page 43, and the correspondence is pages 44 to 46. So if members are content to dispose of that as per the summary note, subject to these exceptions. Item 8.2 at page 47 is correspondence regarding a legislative timetable in regard to school starting age flexibility. The Minister has previously indicated that he had asked officials to revisit and update work on school starting age flexibility, and that he was not in a position to set out how he intends to proceed in terms of legislation or timing. The committee has commissioned Assembly Research to refresh its previous paper on this subject, with an update on practice in other jurisdictions and a summary of relevant arguments. So I would advise that the committee agree to write to the department seeking an updated position from them and timeframe from them on bringing forward legislation regarding school starting age flexibility.
Yeah, thanks for that, Clark. I think there's widespread cross-party support for school starting age flexibility, so members can agree that. Yep.
All right. Item 8.5 at page 65 is correspondence highlighting the need to begin planning post-primary curriculum for 2022. And I would propose that the committee agree to write to the department asking for curriculum planning, what curriculum planning they're putting in place for post-primary in 2022, given the fact that so much learning has been lost during this year.
Agreed. Agreed. Thank you.
Okay.
Might need to unmute yourselves for the all agreed. Thank you. Okay, Clark, thanks.
Item 8.6 at page 67 is correspondence from the Minister of Education providing a copy of the report produced by Deloitte on the review of alternative awarding arrangements 2020, setting out key issues and lessons learned from that process. I propose that you write to CECEA asking that they address the key actions from this report during their briefing. They've been invited for the 10th of February, and also that they provide an update on the development of an action plan to address the key issues in awarding arrangements.
I would agree with that. Members agreed?
Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
Item 88 at page 168 is a response from the department to concerns raised by the Children's Law Centre about the post-primary transfer test, and I would propose that the committee forward that to the Children's Law Centre.
And seek their response. Yep, agreed. Great, members.
And just one last, the department apologised for sending the last little paragraph of your budget briefing this morning. They obviously wanted to give you a complete position, so that came in very, very late.
Okay.
That's all I have on correspondence.
Okay. Members content with correspondence?
Content.
Okay, thank you. Agenda item 9, members, is our forward work programme. Can I refer members to the draft forward work programme at page 199 and inform members that the inter-mental health champion has confirmed attendance for the 3rd of February, that's next Wednesday, and that will be in addition to an update from the department on the Vulnerable Children Action Plan also. The committee had agreed briefings with the Integrated Education Fund on Integrated Education and UNESCO Education Centre on the Religious Education Certificate on Wednesday, the 3rd of March, but is the committee content to reschedule this session until the 3rd of March, given the urgent issues surrounding emotional health and wellbeing of children and the Vulnerable Children Action Plan at this time? Agreed? Yeah, okay. Thank you. Okay, are members content to endorse the forward work programme or have any other items to raise at this time?
Sure, you mentioned the physical education piece. Will it be worthwhile getting a presentation from Healthy Kids who are doing online physical education for kids throughout this pandemic? Will you be getting a quick 1 hour presentation from them in the coming weeks as a matter of priority, actually, because that's one element of education that's been dismissed too much, I believe, during this pandemic. Kids need access to physical activity.
Yeah, I agree. Clark, am I right in saying that on Wednesday the 17th of February, we're scheduled here from Action for Children on Emotional Health and Wellbeing, and then the department on the curriculum sports programme?
Yeah, it would line up there thematically very well. So it's just, you know, if members feel that they have an appetite for that number of briefings in a meeting.
I think we can manage those three sessions appropriately. Yeah. Justin, are you okay to provide details for that to the clerk? Yeah.
Thank you, Justin.
That's great. Okay, members content to endorse the forward work programme for now? Agreed? Thank you. Okay, agenda item 10, any other business members?
Sure, yes.
Thanks, Justin.
Schools have been informed that they can't use the WJEC examinations body for exams. In a recent communication, can we write to the Minister seeking urgent clarification on that, because that has created a huge degree of chaos within certain schools? Why and what's the rationale, and how much does that leave certain schools in the lurch? It's just, they feel it's totally unacceptable.
I have been raised with myself as well, Justin. Yeah, happy to do that. So Clark, proposal is to write to the Minister for Education to seek urgent clarification as to why pupils are unable to sit exams by the WJEC, the awarding body, Justin. Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. Any other business members? No. Okay.
Chair,
go ahead.
This is just, it's really important. I know you'd waste Karen all the best. I just want to do it too. I really do. Would not say this, we're probably on line. I'll just say this quite publicly. I think there was a bit of mischievous reporting this week, and I didn't think it did you any justice, Karen, with regard to your input and what you do for pupils in schools. It did not reflect the views of anybody in this committee. I think you will be a loss to the committee, actually. I really do. For what it's worth, I miss working with you, but I'll see you in the chamber, and I'm sure we'll discuss other things. So best of luck to you, Karen.
Best luck, Karen. Well done.
Thank you, Robbie. Good Thanks, Austin. I'll miss watching Robbie. He's just turning Jerry Boring. The best place camera today.
That's our secret, Karen.
Okay, members. Thanks for that. Unfortunately, without Karen, we'll wait to see who is joining us and they'll get a warm welcome. Our next meeting then is Wednesday, the 3rd of February, in the Senate chamber. Although I say, now that we're at the end of the meeting, it seems like a fully virtual meeting managed to occur without too much hitch. I think my connection failed on two occasions, but thank you to Assembly Broadcasting, who seemed to remedy that with great speed and without too much disruption. So we may reflect on this and endeavour to use the fully virtual format on further occasions as well, given the benefits that it has in the current context. But we are scheduled for Wednesday, the 3rd of February, in the Senate chamber at Parliament Buildings and via Starleaf at 9:30 a.m. And the meeting does now adjourn. Thank you, members. This is